pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, I'm going to run through our agenda. So first up, we have recognitions, followed by our first public comment. Then we'll have reports. We'll have a student council report. We'll have a report from Mr. Bishop on start time. We'll have a report from Dr. Zaleski on coordinated program review. Then we'll have liaisons reports. I'll have a quick vice chair report. We'll have a superintendent's report, and then we're into new business. In new business, we'll have a 0.2 FTE learning specialist request, a stipend approval request, preliminary capital requests, capital project article warrants, and school committee policy KHB, advertising in schools, for a first reading. Then we'll go into old business, where we have school committee policy EHB, electronic records retention, for a second reading. And then school committee policy IJNDB, internet acceptable use, for a third reading. Then we'll have a cross-country trail loop update. And then we'll have our second public comment, followed by items by consensus, and then adjournment. So is there anybody here for public comment who would like to speak? Okay, so then we'll move into reports. So the first one is the student council. If you could join us
up guys.
The microphone.
Welcome. We have David Antaki and Ryan Branch here. And you can tell that they have lots of spirit, so they've got lots of great things to tell us about what's been going on. Welcome, guys.
Thank you for having us. The first thing, I think, as you can see, is we're all spirited out because this week is Spirit Week for Hopkinton, just because on Friday we have our homecoming football game, so that's very exciting. And every year the student council picks spirit days for each day. The juniors, sophomores, and freshmen do their own things. They do, I think Monday was pajama day, Tuesday we had tourist day, Wednesday was America Day, and then today was Color Blast. And then I'm a senior, so we do our own things. So today was Blackout Day. That's why I'm in all black and still have my face paint on. I haven't been able to go home. Also, throughout the week, we have a lot of fun things planned. I know the student council, we put on a competition called Penny Wars, in which each grade has a jar outside of the cafeteria. It's like a picture like a big pretzel jar, kind of, the pretzels coming. And if you drop a penny in for your grade, that's plus 1 point. And then any other currency would be minus 1 point. So if you had a nickel and you were a senior, you could drop it into the junior's jar, and that would be minus 5. And I think we're still finishing counting up all of the money, but we're close to $1,000 off of that already, which is really exciting because that's much more than we've done in years past.
Wow.
And kind of the big thing that Spirit Week leads up to is the pep rally, which is going, they're rehearsing right behind us right now. So you might be able to hear the music, but that's at the end of the day. It's about an hour. And it's just a great day. We have a captain's video that David made, in which all the sports captains and all the club leaders discuss their senior nights, their big conferences, just to get crowds there. And it's just great to show and really emphasize our school spirit. So that's great to see.
All right. And next Wednesday, the 26th, Unite, the program, our group here at the high school that helps freshmen or eighth graders transition to high school as freshmen, much like Ignite in middle school to help the fifth graders to sixth grade. We're going to be having Capture the Flag next Wednesday after school. And so it's open to any of the freshmen. We encourage all of them. We try to get all of them to come if they can, unless they have other extracurricular activities. Mostly Unite mentors go as well, and we create teams and just play Capture the Flag. It's a nice way for to show more school spirit, have some fun with the freshmen, show them what that high school can be fun too. International Night is going to be happening Thursday, next Thursday, the 27th. That's going to be run, that's set up by the Ambassadors Club, a new club this year, to help plan events for the international foreign exchange students. International Night has been going on, though, for a couple years. It's a night for all the international students to represent their countries. So Ambassador Club has committees set up to run tables at International Night here at the high school, and to represent a country for the international students and show off what that country is, culture, things like that, have food, and another way to, a way to engage the international students in the high school and show where they came from and their background.
And following that day, on the 28th, that Friday, we're going to have our second Hiller Day. And I know I can speak from this perspective of a student that the first one went very well. I guess that's a shout out to Mr. Bishop. But it was great to sleep until 7 on a Friday night, Friday morning, as opposed to the normal 6 a.m. wake up. Just made me feel a lot better going in the first period. And it was really cool to see. And then, obviously, soon after that, on the next Monday, I believe, we have the senior Halloween breakfast, which is always very fun and very cool to see all the seniors' costumes and just their school spirit. Again, I guess October's filled with all these school spirit days, but that's just how it is at HHS. Is that everything?
We got November 3rd. Thursday, we're doing the Metro West Adolescent Health Survey. So during advisory, advisory every Thursday, we meet with our advisory teacher. We're going to take this health survey that we take every 2 years. And it's a health survey that we all take and give our honest opinion on issues regarding stress, drugs, other health-related things, and try to provide data to the Metro West. And this year we're looking to improve the stress category. Ambassadors Club again, like International Night. Being put on, we'll be going apple picking. Apple picking was scheduled with the international students for tomorrow at Tugas Farm, but that was postponed because of the rain till next Friday. And now it's going to be pumpkin picking, but that should be just as fun.
Because it could be snow by the following Friday.
Yeah. So apple picking, I think, is done by then.
Yeah.
But, yeah, maybe we'll do some carving, I would assume.
Fun.
I think that's it for the updates from the student council. But tomorrow is the homecoming football game, so it'll be great to see the community there. And the band will be there for a second time. And David and I are both in band. We're having a blast with it. I think that's it for HHS.
That's great. Which band is that?
Both of the high school bands, they combine and they play in the stands. And then the eighth grade band joins us for the homecoming game. So it's extra big tomorrow night.
That's awesome.
Trying to get promote high school band to get eighth graders to continue on.
That's great.
That's excellent. So thanks for being here.
Okay.
I wanted to first of all thank you for being here because we really enjoy it, as you can see. It brings a face to all of the work that happens around you so that there can be such a wonderful program in our schools. But I also just wanted to give a shout out to the students around the health survey, that we really take those results very seriously, and it's really important for people to be honest because it helps us to help you. And so I'm glad that you mentioned it, and I guess I just wanted to, you know, get you to pass the word on that I'm sure you will. That honest input is what we're really looking for. Given that it's an anonymous survey, we look at these across the Metro West, but of course, the data that we're most interested in is what we get from this high school. And it really does drive a lot of decisions that the school committee makes about programs and decisions that Mr. Bishop is making. So thanks for mentioning that. Did you have something, Nancy?
I just wanted to ask, that's a lot of money you raised. Congratulations. Do you have something earmarked for what you're going to do with the $1,000 from the Penny Wars?
I think, so the way it works is the class that won the most money gets half of it, or the class that wins the competition gets half of the money, and then the student council gets the other half. I know we have some other fun events planned, and I guess some more fundraisers planned, but those fundraisers and those events obviously have a cost. So we were going to use that money and put it towards other fun things. I know we have some ideas for the winter and for the spring, but it depends on the weather.
And also it might go towards the scholarships?
Yes, we do give out a student council scholarship every year that you have to apply for. Yeah.
Well done.
Excellent.
Thank you.
So go get ready for Spirit Day.
We will.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good night.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you for having us.
Is Mr. Bishop around?
Or did yes.
He? Oh, there he is.
He's hiding. It's hard to not see him.
So next up, we have the Start Time Committee Report by Mr. Bishop. And then should I ask them now about the reordering?
Sure.
Would it be okay with you guys if we moved up Mr. Bishop's stipend approval after this so he can stay up here? All right.
Hello. Hey, hello. How are you guys? Good evening, and thanks for having us. Hey, Ms. Benbenek and I just wanted to say how much we appreciate you giving us a little bit of time to talk a little bit about the conversations that we've been having both at the high school and at the middle school over the past year and a half or so in regards to exploring a later start time at the secondary levels here in Hopkinton. I think it's important to start at the outset here to talk a little bit about how there is considerable data in regards to adolescent sleep patterns, particularly over the last few years, and it was highlighted by a study done by the American Academy of Pediatrics, and it's a pretty significant survey and study that we don't have time to go through all the pages, certainly, but to give you the basic of the survey is that high school students aren't getting enough sleep, and I think we all know that. And it's tough to deny it given the amount of things that our students are involved in on a daily basis. And I think we would all agree that having high school students get more sleep would be a good thing, and it would certainly be beneficial across the board for a vast majority of students. And so no one's arguing the point that a later start time would not be beneficial. What we were charged with, however, was looking into trying to accommodate this change, but doing so in a cost-effective way, and in a way that wasn't going to impact the entire school community. Also, just to add some context around some of these studies that have been done lately around adolescent sleep, the recommendation is that high schools start school and middle schools from 8:30 on, and that's what the research says. And so for us here in Hopkinton, that would be an hour and 5 minute shift. So we start our school days at 7:25. So we did a little bit of research over the last few months, and I provided you guys with packets. We looked at 230 other public high schools in Massachusetts. And what we saw, it was surprising to us. Only 20 of the 230 schools actually start school at 8 a.m. or later. And only 3 of those 20 start school at 8:30 or later. So I'm sure there are adults and students in all of those communities, those 230 communities, that understand that a later start time and sleep is so important to our students, but a lot of school districts are struggling with how to make that happen, given the many factors that also are incorporated in trying to make this change. And that's what we're going to talk a little bit about tonight. So just kind of going back a step, this topic of a later start time has been discussed at the high school for probably over 2 or 3 years in a variety of different venues, from school council to principal's cabinet to even just casual conversations that I've had with parents on the side of the athletic fields, to be honest with you. So last year, our school council decided to take it on. We took our December meeting, our school council meeting, and we reviewed research on the topic of adolescent sleep patterns. We read articles. And we looked into communities around the area that have either made the switch or that were going to make the switch to a later start time and what the pros and cons were. The middle school was also having these conversations around the same time. So in February, we had both school councils come together, which was around 30 people or so of students, teachers, community members, and parents. And we talked more at length about the idea of a start time and how could it happen here in Hopkinton if we were going to make it work. And during that meeting, the idea of a later start time was actually met with mixed feelings. And most surprisingly, it was met with mixed feelings from the students, the 10 students that were part of the 30-person committee. They, of course, would want to sleep a little bit later, as Ryan just said, but they were not willing to make that decision if it was going to add another hour and 5 minutes onto the end of their day. So at that point, it was determined that maybe we should step back and have a start time subcommittee from these councils. So we had members of the middle school council, the high school council, and we invited members from the Hopkins School Council. And so we communicated on email between the months of February and April last year. We had a meeting in April, and then we communicated also again through email after that meeting in April. And it was a group of very open-minded people. It was a group that people did not have agendas going into this. We tried to look at it objectively, and we talked a lot about the pros and also the things we need to consider in order to make this happen, because there's a lot of different factors. And I think the committee recognized pretty quickly that any potential change in start time would have an effect on a large portion of the Hopkinton school community. It would have an impact on all five buildings, just the way our schools are set up here in Hopkinton, family schedules, elementary schedules, and transportations on several fronts. And from a high school's perspective, you take that coupled with the high demand for time after school for our students, whether it be through athletics or theater or work or maybe helping out with a younger sibling. It complicated things. There was a lot of things that we had to think about. But I do feel the probably the biggest roadblock that we faced was around transportation and the difficulties with that and the costs with that. So I'm actually going to turn it over to Ms. Benbenek, who's going to talk a little bit about the scenarios that we came up with and some of the things that we discussed in regards to transportation.
So I think in your packet you saw that what was brought forward were three different proposals that involved busing. And in each of them, we were hit with either a financial consideration or a great impact on how this affects. So right now we transport our students in three waves, middle school, high school together, Hopkins, and then Elmwood and Center separately. And in order to not impact and push back everybody's start time, and we consider doing two waves of busing. But in order to do two waves of busing, which would put middle school, high school, and Hopkins, so the middle school and high school would start roughly, you know, and Hopkins could all start school at 8:30 together, that meant adding 6 to 8 buses. And at $60,000 per bus, we were looking at an increase of potentially $480,000, which, as all of you know, is a huge financial, you know, concern for our school district and our community. So then we looked at restructuring a little bit and putting the middle school and high school together and Hopkins and Elmwood and Center School together. And the issue that presented with the way our school district is structured, we don't have communities, neighborhood schools, was that we had students who might need to be on the bus for up to an hour and a half, because now we're putting the three schools, so again, two waves, three schools, and an hour and a half for an elementary school child is, you know, for a middle school child, for an adult is too long, never mind for potentially what that could mean for our students. And that would mean potentially students not getting home till 4:30, 4:45, you know, so that presented our own concerns, not necessarily financial, but just not what's best for students. And then the third was swapping, having the high school start later and having the middle school and Hopkins start earlier. But then we're looking at fourth graders potentially getting on the bus at 6:30 in the morning, which is what some of our high school students do. And as we know, elementary school kids need a little bit more hand-holding or care in getting ready in the morning. They're the ones who can't grab the granola bar on the way out the door like maybe our high school kids do. So you're talking about potentially getting your child up at 5:30 to make sure they're dressed and eat a good breakfast before they're out the door. And again, it might benefit our high school students who need more sleep, but it wasn't really benefiting all of our students. And as much as we, you know, Evan would like to see his students sleep longer, it not at the detriment of what how that's going to impact our other students. And so those were our transportation concerns and how those played out and why they weren't really favorable, a favorable result. We tried to think outside the box a little bit and think about other ways of transportation, but none of those just seemed like they were reliable or really realistic in transporting high school students or any of our students to school. Some other concerns that were brought forward were if we're starting our elementary school kids later, there might be a greater need for before school care. And where is the cost for that gonna come? Is it gonna be subsidized by the school? Families might need to pay for it, but now we're asking families to fund, you know, to pay for this, and so that could be a financial burden. Even if it was at no cost to the district, it could be at a cost to our families. And again, athletics and other extracurricular, I mean, a lot of our students work and they are in theater and they do things beyond. And that's what our high school students brought to us that day at the school council meeting. They're like, I'm still gonna have all the athletics and I'm still gonna have my homework. It's still gonna need to get done. And so I'm probably not gonna get up in the morning to do it. So now I'm gonna go to bed later. You know, and so the students who were there, which were, you know, highly committed kids to their education, but as well as to being well-rounded students, and they were the ones who said, I think that's going to stress me out. And the whole point of this was not just to alleviate stress and bring them more sleep. So that's why we came to the group came to the conclusion that to further consider this might be too much of a burden to our entire school community. And so the high school and the middle school is trying to do things to alleviate and work on the stress of our students that isn't going to give them any more sleep time, but would, if we took away their stress and anxiety around the things in life that bring it, then potentially they'll just have better quality of wake time. Do you want to talk about the things?
Absolutely. So, I mean, it's, again, I think it's important to mention we see the benefits of it. At this point, for us at this time, we just didn't think it outweighed the cost and the disruption that it could possibly cause across the district. So we would like to try to promote a little bit more of the efforts that we're currently doing in the current structure that we have. At the high school, for those of you who know, we've had what we call senior privileges. So when a senior has a free block during the day, they're able to leave the building. So if it's first period, they can come in a little bit late. We instituted junior privileges last year. And so if a junior is in good academic standing, has a good discipline record, if they have a first period study, they can come in a little bit late. And that was met with great reviews. The kids really, really liked that. And then this year, we are starting what we're calling Hiller Days. And so it's the last Friday of every month. We're starting school at 8 o'clock. It's dual purpose. It's to explore the later start time, but also to allow our teachers to have some common planning time together. We've only had one, and I know Ryan talked about it. It was great. I know that there was a little bit of a traffic issue with Hopkins that we will certainly work out when we talk to the kids just to keep them in their minds. But from our perspective, it went really well. And so I think we're going to see how this goes. When I talked to kids, they loved it, but when they said, well, do you don't want to do a later start time all the time? They said, no, it's kind of nice to have this treat, so to speak, every once in a while. So could we offer more Hiller Days potentially as we get through this? But I want to see how this year goes with having one a month, see how it goes with the common planning with staff with the later start time, and then at the end of the year we can address if we wanted to have more of those. But so I guess in general, you can pretty much tell from us, we just feel at this point we just can't recommend to you wanting to change our start times. I don't think it's a conversation that we should table forever. I think that there's going to be more research that comes out. I think a lot of it depends on the teams in our league and what they're going to be doing with their start time. So it might be something we can come back to at another time. But at this point, we didn't feel comfortable giving all the information to recommend that to you guys.
Great. Anyone have any questions?
I really want to commend you for how thorough a look you took at this. It's a topic that I see all the time, you know, like you said, on the sidelines or on social media or whatever. And I think at the end of the day, there are only 24 hours in a day, and so you can start them or end them earlier, but our kids are just tremendously busy. And so, you know, I think what you've demonstrated is it's really just robbing Peter to pay Paul. And so I really think that the creative approach of occasionally having the Hiller Day and the junior privilege thing for, you know, not coming in first period is a great idea. So I appreciate that you're trying to be creative and give them what you can and recognize that they are stressed and they do need a break as often as we can give it to them. And you've also added into that a lot of things that you didn't mention about homework-free weekends and all of that stuff. So I think all of that is great. And I mean, certainly can't say that there isn't a concerted effort to try to reduce the stress that our kids are dealing with, and as well to teach them to learn to manage their own stress, which is a skill that they need for their life. So, you know, to me, it comes down to the same kind of conversation that we had around the calendar and moving to one vacation. Unless it's something that our whole region is going to do, it's going to end up creating more stress and complication for our kids than it probably would solve. And so so I think this is great research, and as you said, I wouldn't want to see it get shelved and forgotten about, but you know, it'll be ready when possibly conditions change in the future and could take another look. But anyway, that's just a long-winded way of saying thank you very much. I think this is really comprehensive.
I agree, very thorough job. It also, I think when you embarked on this, my hope had been that there would be a simple solution, something certainly less costly than $60,000 a bus. So I appreciate all that you put into it. Thank you.
Yeah, I think this helps answer a lot of questions for the community. I mean, we continue to get inquiries to at the school committee level, and so that the fact that, this data, these options have been researched, again, I think everybody would have liked to find a solution that, would have solved all the problems, but I think this is great work.
I just had one small question in that the wave two with the 1.5 hours, that's based on the current center location. Does the, I can't imagine that the new school location brings it down to a manageable time, but that's based on current.
Well, I think because students
school.
Are still transported from all over
across,
the town to
right.
one location. I mean, it's different in towns that have those neighborhood schools
right.
that don't have. So I think by moving it 2 miles down, it's
not going to be
Yeah, I don't think it's
going to
have as okay. great an impact as.
Yeah. All right. Would also require yeah. additional buses, I would imagine, to put all three elementary schools.
I'd have to go back to the original information, but that wasn't something that was, for some reason, I think it was going to be able to work, but I agree with you. If we're on two ways, it feels like it should
right?
be additional,
yeah.
so I might have missed that.
There's enough room on the elementary buses
there
to
is.
Do it. Yeah.
Okay.
It was the time.
It was the time.
Time.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you.
Okay. All right. Otherwise, I echo. It feels like everyone was like, kids need more sleep. You need to mm-hmm. let them wake up later, and then the reality is what you guys have really put in paper. So thank you very much.
Other than this presentation, is this going to be communicated out to parents just so they can see how thoroughly you investigated this?
So I'll follow up with Evan and Ann, and we'll put together a communication that goes out basically summarizing what they've presented
yeah,
to you
I
tonight.
Think that would be great because
okay.
this is a lot of
great idea.
A lot of time and effort. People. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
All right. So we'll have Mr. Bishop stay,
Great.
And then we're going to jump into new business quickly so he can go through the stipend approval request.
Yes. Yeah, so,
Anne's actually staying too, right? Okay.
Actually, do you want to have her go first?
No.
Oh,
thank
sure.
you.
Oh, okay.
I forgot. My mistake.
Oh.
So you go ahead.
Okay. I'll try to be quick. I know you guys have a packed agenda. So I'm here in terms of our stipends to get our approval to reallocate some of the funds in our stipend account. I think I've mentioned this before to you a number of times, we have more clubs than we do stipends to fund them. And oftentimes we have very dedicated staff members running clubs for a year, 2 years, sometimes even more without getting compensated for it. And so this year we actually had some additional money become available. We had a stipend for what we called the Junior Experience, which was a program that we had where there was an advisor working with the entire junior class trying to get the students 5 hours of either a community service requirement or a job shadow, and we felt that that model wasn't working the way we wanted to. So we're actually in the process of kind of revamping that. So that stipend became available, that $3,000 stipend. And we also had a significant interest in students wanting to have yearbook as a class, and so we offered that as a class this year. And so we were able to take the $2,500 stipend from that as well and have that be in the stipend account. So that's why there is $4,250 available. That's kind of rare when it comes to our stipend account. And then the nine clubs that you see here on this memo are clubs that have been running for at least a year, some of which have been running for 6 or 7 years without stipends. And so they include a women in STEM club, a Chinese club, a fashion club, jazz club, we call it Noteworthy, but it's our a cappella club. A fishing club, a history club, a speech club, and having a morning fitness club. Right now we have an afternoon fitness club 4 days a week, and we have one of our staff members that is coming in Tuesday and Thursday mornings at 6 a.m. and opening up the weight room, and we have on average about 15 kids in there coming, so we wanted to try to compensate that person as well. So this money is existing. We're just kind of shifting it over to some of these other clubs to get them funded. So I don't know if you have any questions on any of the clubs or
I think
process.
Our packet says $3,750 and
it
does not
Evan.
Have a fashion club.
That's what that adds to.
We have $3,750
in our middle. Mentioned a fashion
you have fashion?
Club.
Fashion.
We don't
fashion.
Have that.
Oh, I have fashion on mine.
Fashion club too.
So Evan, we have a total of $3,750 in our memo,
mm-hmm.
And so the fashion club. Where did the additional $500 come from to fund that?
As part of the Junior Experience and. So there's $5,500 of additional money now.
Okay.
And $4,250 of that is going to go to these nine clubs.
Okay.
So there still is going to be some additional money that's unclaimed at this point with the site.
So we'll need to get the right number for the motion.
Yeah, so it's $4,250.
$4,250. Okay. Yeah, it was another $500 for the fashion club. Sorry about that.
Okay.
This doesn't have a money amount in it, so I need
because
amended.
We can't really do this motion because it's not appropriately outlined in this
in
agenda
the
materials.
So
right.
Do we just need to say as amended, though?
No, because we haven't amended the memo.
Oh, okay.
I think we need to use a dollar amount.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
In the amount of?
$4,250.
Okay. Does anyone have any other questions? Okay. So I'd seek a motion to approve the stipend request allocated. Oh, so the stipend request allocation in the amount of $4,250.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Motion by Ms. Birchman, second by Ms. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So it's unanimous and so carries.
Item A would be very quick, too, if you don't mind.
Sorry? You want me to?
Item A would be very
okay,
quick.
Okay, so that's the last thing we need Mr. Bishop for, correct?
Yeah. Yes.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Bishop.
Thank you. Have a nice night.
Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you, Evan.
Thank you, guys.
So I believe Ms. Benbenek is coming back up for item A under new business. So we'll let her come up so she can finish up her business with us. So this is the 0.2 FTE learning specialist.
Thanks, Anne, for being here.
Hello.
I'm going to begin, if that's okay. You've heard us talking for 2 years now about the importance of a reading coach and the importance of hiring people as a support to our teachers, developing intervention plans, etc. And we were able to have that position approved in last year's budget for the middle school and interviewed in the summer and hired an extremely talented reading coach who had been one of the teachers at the middle school. So she had already established relationships with people, and we were very excited to get started. As we've talked before, we're in the middle of the budget process now for what is to come next fall. So when school opened, or in the summer, we were programming for incoming fifth graders, there were some significant needs identified for a group of students whose IEPs we couldn't meet with the current staffing. So Alan needed to use this position with all of her many talents to meet the needs of students, mostly on IEPs, preventing her from having the time to do the coaching. We did come to you and asked for an increase of a 0.4 FTE and have, to this point now, end of October, unable to fill that position. We believe it's because it's just not attractive, a 0.4 position for somebody to come. There's no benefits attached to it. And we can often find that the special education pool can be shallow at best. So, Anne, I'll turn it over to you to add to my introduction.
So we've been able to cover the needs of those students who should have had the services of the 0.4 position internally with a lot of relying on other staff members. And then as we've gotten to know our students even more, we've determined that there is still another group that we needed to implement, another reading group. And so instead of just being able to service these students through two of what a 0.4 would be, two extra classes, we've determined that there's a third group as well. And so we're depending a lot more heavily on our literacy coach, which is, you know, if we're looking at a six period day, three of those periods she's with students in a small group setting. I mean, her ideal is to be with students but with teachers in a coaching, working with teachers individually and then co-teaching with them to model what those reading strategies look like in the academic classrooms. And right now, because we need her to be servicing these small groups, she's not able to do what ideally that position was. And so though she's having a great impact on those small group of students, ideally we'd like her to have an impact which would be impacting the way our teachers teach the reading skills. And she can do that by working with the science teacher in the science classroom, modeling how those reading skills look in the larger classroom, in the content areas, which will then impact all of our students. You know, if we can strengthen those reading skills in the teachers this year, then those teachers will walk away with those skills in the long term. And so we would like to be able to increase that 0.2 position again, because, you know, we can reach out to a greater amount of applicants, but again, because it's what's best for meeting the needs of our students as a whole, not just the small group of students who are in IEPs, but every sixth grader, all 286 of them will be impacted if the literacy coach can be in with all of the teachers versus just with these three small groups.
Well, you've certainly been able to prove that with your performance in terms of just really targeting and incredible results this year. And it's very convincing, you know, when you're asking for something like this, we know that it's needed or wouldn't be being requested. So I certainly support the request.
All right. Anyone have any questions or comments?
Go ahead. I just want to be clear. So we're going from it's the same position. We're going from a 0.44 to a 0.6.
Correct.
So now is that including benefits?
Yes.
Okay. And this comes out of the prepaid?
Well, the funds ultimately will be transferred into the middle school special ed teacher account from the savings and the SPED prepaid.
That we'd had at the end of last year.
So we're at the point, almost at the point where in 2 weeks I'll be ready to give you some budget transfers that will deal with all of this.
Okay.
On the 0.4 to 0.2, directionally, how much money are we talking about?
Well, it depends upon who we hire.
Right.
So 0.2 of 60,000 is 12,000.
Okay.
0.2 of 97,000 is, what, 19,000?
Yeah, so somewhere, I was thinking somewhere between 10 and 20. So that's about, okay.
So I know we said that the 0.4 position wasn't very attractive out in the job market. Do we think that between the going to 0.6 and it being a benefits eligible position, this is going to be?
Oh, definitely.
Okay.
We interviewed several candidates throughout the summer and got to a point where we offered the position to one who, unfortunately, when she learned of the hours and the pay of what that would be for her, declined the position. And so I think, I mean, that was some of the feedback that we got from her was, oh, that's it. Because it impacts, you know, if they have childcare needs or all those things, you know, coming into a position that pays potentially, you know, not what it costs to put your child in daycare, especially with the way our schedule functions, it's not an easy you come in for the first two periods of the day type of situation. So I can tell you from that one candidate, that was exactly what she said.
Any other questions? Okay, so I would seek a motion to approve the addition of a 0.2 FTE learning specialist to be funded by the operating budget, prepaid SPED.
So moved.
Second.
All right, so moved by Ms. Kavanaugh, seconded by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. So it's unanimous and so carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate you moving the time up this morning. Thanks. Have a good night.
Okay, so we will go back up into the report section. So next up we have, just in time for our technical support to have saved the day,
right?
Our coordinated program review report from Dr. Zaleski.
Thank you.
Welcome.
Thank you. Good evening.
Good evening.
So a coordinated program review was conducted in the district, and for those of you folks who are not quite sure what that might mean, it's a review by the Department of Education for our special education department, and they look at special education areas as well as civil rights areas. So as you can see up on the screen, they came out for an on-site visit in March, and then they gave us a series of findings, which were publicly posted. And then they gave us a deadline to submit an action plan for each item. So our status as of right now is we've submitted the action plan and items. So I'm going to go through very briefly the items so you can have a better understanding of where we stand as a district. So just as an overview, there are 59 special education areas that are evaluated and 26 civil rights areas. So we're fully implemented in all areas except for four special education areas, in 4 civil rights areas. And those areas were partially implemented. So we didn't have findings of not implemented. It was partially implemented in those areas. So overall, we're doing quite well as a district, but we can always get better. So that's the goal. So the first area, SE, standing for special education, is SE 18A, and it consists of IEP development and content. So basically what they said in this portion is that the team does a really good job of identifying students who have needs pertaining to bullying and harassment and teasing, but one of the areas we fall short on is we're not consistently addressing that in the goal areas. So we're often mentioning it in additional information portion of the IEP, and we are discussing it with families, but we're not as clearly outlining it in the goals and objectives as we should be. So the action that I've submitted has been accepted to the department from the Department of Ed is that I'm going to provide training to the team chairs on exactly what the goals and objectives should look like. And also, I have to provide evidence by way of a record review in March to the Department of Education showing that we have, in fact, based on our training, made some effective changes throughout the IEPs where this is an area of concern for some students. Make sense? And I don't know if you folks want to ask questions after each slide, or do we want me to just present because you may forget an area? How do you wish I proceed?
You guys just want to ask questions along the way, if you have them?
Sure.
Yeah. Although I don't have any questions.
Then you don't
that.
Have
okay,
to.
Okay, so we're all set?
Yes.
Okay,
so then
great.
We'll keep it like a conversation, and if there's a question, they'll jump right in.
That'll be great.
Okay,
thanks. Sure. So in SE 18B, it's determination of placement in the provision of IEP. So again, we've been, there's a lot of narrative that was in the report, and it basically stated that we're very good about identifying how students are placed on the IEP grid and how we are providing the information to families, but we're falling short on the timeline. So the legislation states that within 2 weeks we have to get that information out to parents. And so we conducted a root cause analysis as part of my action planning, and part of my findings revealed that at the different building levels, although all the information is prepared and the reports are ready to go out, we didn't have a good tracking system as to when that's going out. So for instance, we all know the timelines and the deadlines. Everybody's trained for years and years. However, oftentimes it would be handed maybe to a secretary or a building-based support staff. And when that happens, it could sit on someone's desk for a day or two, and then it goes to central office for mailing. And then by the time it gets mailed and parents receive it, we're missing those deadlines. So what we've done, and I've proposed to the Department of Ed, is that we are going to provide training, some more training to the team chairs. I actually already met with building-based secretarial support staff. So at the beginning of the school year, I had a district-wide training, and we created a timeline, a Google Doc tracking sheet, so they could identify every aspect of the IEP, all the timelines and dates that they would do, and it's shared amongst everybody. And most importantly, with the team chairs. So the team chairs can pull up that grid and say, it's due in 2 days. I've given all the information that needs to get to central office for the mailing. So I feel like that's going to be very effective. We've received a lot of feedback from the support staff, and we're pretty excited about it because already folks have been emailing me and clarifying times and making sure we're on track with different aspects of the IEP process. So that's how we're addressing that area.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
Is this the initial IEP, or is this every time there's a team meeting with a family?
So every time there's a team meeting, we have a deadline to get out the IEP. And
okay.
So along the way with that, there's many different deadlines depending on what's happening in the team process. So if we give parents a draft, we have a certain timeline. If they go home without a draft, then the timeline is shorter. We're tracking all of that. Because what I decided, and the team chairs agreed, that although the 2-week timeline, which is the 10 days to get the IEP out, is something we're being monitored on, we want to make sure we're not missing any deadlines. And we weren't cited for missing all the deadlines, but I want to make sure we don't get cited for missing all the deadlines. So while we created this tracking system, we figured it was good to put every aspect and component of the timelines for, you know, the N1 notification to families and the 5 days versus the 10 days, depending on the circumstance.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. I think it was just the proposed word that I didn't know if it was just the initial that was the issue or if it's
so
every time.
So proposed, just for clarity, I'm glad that you asked. Anytime that you have an IEP, the document is never permanent, it's always proposed because the family has 30 days to respond and to sign and get it back to us. So regardless of the meeting type, and this would definitely apply to initials, and then it would apply to a family calls a team meeting and wants to revise a goal area, and we propose something different, that's a proposed IEP. And until they officially sign and accept it, it's always in proposed.
Okay, thank you.
And then it goes into, you know, accepted or rejected status. Okay. So SE20, this is the least restrictive programming. And there was a lot of narrative to this, but I'm going to just summarize it. At the high school level, students are not always placed in the least restrictive environment. Specifically, they focused on the ELA math foundation courses. And basically, the dilemma here is, so we have foundation courses at the high school which provide rich remediation to our students who need support in the area of ELA and math. And it really is a wonderful course for struggling learners. But the dilemma for us is we very eagerly placed the students into this program, but on the service delivery grid, we wrote it as full inclusion. And so when the reviewers came out, they pointed out to us that, you know, we really shouldn't call it full inclusion because there were a lot of special education students in there. And if it's, you know, the majority of special education students receiving services, you really can't call it full inclusion. You have to call it what it is, which is a substantially separate environment. So we're working to make those shifts and changes on the service grid. And then, again, we want to do a really good job with this. So we also came up with the idea to provide entrance criteria as to who gets placed and why. Stakeholder involvement, involving all players, not just, you know, a guidance council decision. We want to involve team chairs in the process and the entire team that's coming to the table, because if we feel a student needs to be in this course and they ask special education, we should have that whole conversation. And then also rewriting the service delivery grid to reflect what it is. So we believe that will satisfy the requirement of the coordinated program review, and I've gotten some guidance from the Department of Education regarding these components to make those changes. I've already had some working sessions with Mr. Bishop and Dr. Kavanaugh to analyze the curriculum in those courses and feel confident that we're going to keep those courses intact. We just need to call it what it is. Okay. Any further questions or any? No? We're good? So SE24, so notice to parent is called an N1 form. There are six components to the N1 form, but what the review has found is that these two components, we don't necessarily, you know, address specifically. So what happens, and the further training I want to be providing to the team chairs, and we've already had some discussion around this because we did a random record review ourselves when this came out. Our team chairs are really good writers. They write a lot of information as to what's going on in the meeting. But the problem with that is by writing a really good story about what's happening, these pieces are getting mixed up in the process. And so it's not as clear. So the guidance that I'm going to be providing the chairs with is within the six components, just state it like it is. If we've done an evaluation, let's say in the area of speech, state this is the evaluation, this is the results. Because what happens when you tell the story, for instance, you know, Johnny came in, he really struggles to articulate, he might need some help, the team is going to propose some services. That's not as clear as saying an evaluation was conducted, these are the results. And that's what the coordinated program reviewers' feedback was that we write a lot and we're doing a good job at that, but it's too much and things are getting lost in translation. So that's what we're working to correct. Same thing with the rejected options. At the bottom of the note, after you conduct an IEP meeting, you have to state to the families if anything's rejected, if there's disagreement, and why it was rejected. So we're pretty good at saying, you know, this is rejected and, you know, the family needs to respond to the IEP and we have to take, you know, the next steps. But we need to get better at stating why it was rejected. You know, Mrs. Smith disagrees with the evaluation findings and feels. So we've got to get a better job of really explaining that so it's clear to an outside reader in the event an advocate's involved or we brought another member of the team to further analyze results. Okay. So this is the civil rights portion of the coordinated program review, and Dr. Kavanaugh has taken this portion on with me. And school committee's involved in this piece, but basically these were really minor minor areas that were looked at. Within the program of studies at the high school, language based on legislation is that you have to add gender identity and homelessness, and I know that she's already worked to correct that.
Yeah,
and
then
it's done, right? And it needs to be approved by you folks, so that's one area. And then another area, I think this is done as well, is accessibility of extracurricular activities. Same thing, it was language change, and that needs your approval. And the reason I wrote ongoing review and approval is because the reviewers don't want you to ever think that it's a done deal and we forget about it and we never look at it ever again. We have to always be monitoring as a policy and planning committee, legislation changes, and it gets brought forward to school committee. So Carol Kavanaugh will be working with Dr. McLeod to continue to monitor that. CR 16 pertains to students who might leave school without a high school diploma. So what happens is when students leave, we give them a letter basically inviting them to please return or work with us so we can help you if you are not going to finish your education. But what the review has found is that our letters doesn't contain an exit interview offering. And so we need to put that in with the 10-day timeline for them to respond to us. And as you see, I wrote up here program information. So when we send a letter home to families, we might say, you know, we're inviting you, please, to come to an exit interview. We want to talk about why you're not coming to school, and we want to help you with this. We want to give them the 10-day timeline that we're here, you know, we're available. Because if you keep it open-ended, they may never get back to you. And the program information is, you know, if a student wants to do a different type of education, if they want to obtain a GED, let's say they want to go to a vocational program, or they want support regarding maybe attending like a residential, like a job corps type program to get on-site work training while they're finishing their education, our letter doesn't contain those details about where they can go for help. And so we're working to update and make that change, myself and Dr. Kavanaugh. Okay, any questions?
I do have one question. So the exit interview is with the student or the parents or both?
Oh, it would go to both. It would definitely go to both. But the letter is primarily addressed to the student, but it's usually to the family of, and then it's to, you know, Sean Smith, because we want to invite the student specifically to come in and meet with us. And always families are invited absolutely as part of that process because, as we all know, family support is critical. You know, and sometimes these students might really be lost in needing that support. So we do invite the families to come in for a meeting with us. But we want the student to know that we care, and really it's addressed to you. Mm-hmm. We miss you. We want you here. Okay. And then CR 25 is an institutional self-evaluation. So the finding is that we're not evaluating aspects of the K-12 program to ensure students have access to athletics and extracurricular. Basically, what we need to do is develop a document, which we already did develop a document, and we submitted this to the reviewers. And actually, they sent the document back to us as an exemplary model to use. And we thought that was great because when we got it back, I was like, oh, if they're using our model for the state, then maybe we don't have to correct this. So they kind of chuckled and basically said that, you know, yes, this is an exemplary model. Please use the document, but we have to implement it. So we've created the document. It's just we have to do a better job of disseminating the information at the building levels, and Dr. Kavanaugh and I are working on that, and just making sure that all the students that are involved in athletics or any other extracurricular know how to access those programs so we can have equitable levels of participation. Okay. And that's it.
Do you folks? First slide, Karen.
Yes.
How many,
there we go. Areas evaluated. So I just wanted to just commend you on that.
Thank you.
The ones that you're talking about tonight don't seem like they're going to be difficult to fix. Mm-mm. The most challenging one is the high school placement.
Yes.
But, you know, you didn't, and we didn't ask you to, mm-hmm. the requirements of some of these other elements are significant.
Mm-hmm.
And we all felt really great at the end of the CPR to know that, by and large, we are meeting, mm-hmm. more than meeting, in some cases exceeding the requirements of the state. And I think that's to your credit.
Thank you.
To the work that you've done, mm-hmm. since you've gotten here, to all of your chairs and your teachers and your staff. because I know that some of those things that passed would not have.
Thank you.
If it wasn't for some of the work that you've been doing since you got here. So, you know, you should feel really great about this review. And I know that, by and large, everything that's been requested is already in place. Mm-hmm. We actually have a year in which to implement all of this, and, and it's only the end of October. Mm-hmm. But if there's something on your table, I know you're burning to get at it.
That's it, right.
And so it sounds like the ongoing communication and then the evidence that they're asking for that you've implemented, you know, by March, April is what you're continuing to work on.
Yes, thank you for that. And just so the committee knows, too, to Dr. McLeod's point, and thank you again, some of the other areas were really important areas, and we got commendable on all the rest of those areas, which is family involvement and engagement, transition planning across the grade spans, our community involvement and connections, finances, all aspects of special education that you could possibly think of, we got commendable on. So I'm pretty excited about it. You know, we always take every component seriously, but I am very excited that we did receive commendable for the other work, and it's well recognized within the report.
Would you share that report with the school committee, Karen, so that they could see that feedback as well?
Sure. It's posted on my website.
Oh, the entire report?
The entire report is posted. The coordinated program, right. So by law, when you receive the report, you have to make it public. So I did do this presentation to the CPAC. We, you know, reviewed it and went through the different components, and it has been posted on my website and in a recent newsletter. If you would like me to, you know, email it to the school committee specific, I could.
No, I just wanted to have access.
Okay.
That's great. Thank you.
Okay.
I've forgotten that.
Okay.
Great.
So, question I have about the coordinated program review is, how often does this happen?
So it's every 6 years.
Okay.
And so what happens is, but every 3 years they do a mid-cycle review. So the advantage I have coming in is it's now done, right? I went through it last year, so we're good. And then so what will happen is 3 years from the date of when they came out, which was March, so count 3 years from March of 2016, they will come back and do a mid-cycle review because it's their progress report on us, really. They want to make sure that we're continuing to do well. And they also, it's really good that they do this because they give us the chance in the mid-cycle, if they catch something else that's going on, to correct it before the actual next review, which is 3 years from that time. So they're always keeping us mindful, which is a really good thing. And I tell staff all the time, this is really an opportunity for growth and improvement. And it's a good thing to have so we can remain, you know, doing what we need to do to the best of our ability.
Great.
I think I do have one question. I feel like last year or the year before we had some kind of a similar review of our preschool. Is that in conjunction with this? Like part of, I don't remember the title of that.
NAACI.
It was their accreditation.
It's the NAACI.
That was their accreditation.
Yes. Okay. So that's separate. So
okay.
I call it NAACI. It's the NAEYC report, and we were completely accredited, and so we had positive results on that. But that is absolutely separate from this report.
Okay, so preschool is not included in this, but it's K-12.
No,
K-22.
Well, this is they look at all programs across the district pre-K-12.
Okay.
But the NAEYC report that you're speaking of is a specific separate, similar to like NEASC at the high school.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
All right.
Excellent. Congratulations.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thanks for being bumped out of line here for waiting, but it turned out great because we got your presentation.
Yes.
So.
And let's thank Ashok for helping me get up and going and coming in. So thank you.
Thanks, Karen. Okay.
Thank you. Have a good night, Karen.
Okay, so we're going to move on to liaison reports. Did anyone have a liaison meeting between the last meeting and now you'd like to give an update on?
Which one of the three of us would like to talk about the athletic fields?
Oh yeah, I forgot about that.
All right, then I'll do it.
I forgot.
We had our first athletic field subcommittee meeting on Monday, which was great. I think it's going to be a really good committee, a lot of energy in the room. We got a schedule set for the next couple of meetings, including a public forum, which is going to be on November 7th, right?
Yep.
7th or 9th. And I think a listserv already went out.
The listserv went out, yep.
Advertising that. So hopefully people will be engaged in that process and come and hear what what we're doing and share their feedback with us, but I think this is going to be a good committee.
Yeah, and I echo that, and I think that to just to highlight too that first public forum is really about, I think we've really defined it as our opportunity to listen to the mm-hmm. community and hear what the community's priorities are around right. the athletic fields. So we really want to have as much attendance as possible so that we can hear what are those priorities from the community before we really dig into this work.
Do you have a location for that yet?
Do we have a location for that yet?
We do have a location. The location is right here.
There you go.
On the field?
No, right here. Yeah, that was included in the listserv.
Okay.
Yep.
Nancy, did you?
The Irvine Todaro Property Committee is going to be presenting to the Board of Selectmen on the survey and where the committee is at right now, so if people are interested in seeing the PowerPoint.
On Tuesday or on a future
November
meeting?
1st, sorry.
November 1st.
And then the Youth Commission also met and looking at events that are going on throughout the year, Martin Luther King Day, other things.
Thank you.
Anything from you? I have ESBC here.
ESBC.
Okay, so I attended ESBC last night. Dr. McLeod is there too. So really they're gearing up for the groundbreaking, which is next Friday, the 28th, parking at EMC Park, and then walking in through the new path that's been cut between the two mm-hmm. properties. Do not go down what's looking like the new driveway. That'll be blocked off by big trucks. So that'll be at 10 a.m. on the 28th. So that's the big, big thing. So everything is gearing up for construction is where we are now. So they're out to bid for subcontractors, for you name it. Those are due in by November 9th. There's a pre-qualification round that's going on with some of the experts in the building world that are on the committee. They were picking a steel contractor today. They were down to two, and I don't know if you know which one they picked.
No, they wouldn't tell me. Okay. One of them was Canadian.
One of them
and they
was
were
Canadian.
That back.
One of them was American. So they're also waiting on just minutia here. Soil samples that are taken to determine like where the dirt can go. You know, they're really into some logistics that's going on the site. If you've gone by on Hayden Row at all, the site is cleared. They actually got down all of the trees. They were carting them off the site. I know if you've seen big trucks full of big, massive tree trunks, they've gotten those out. Now they're working on getting the root systems out. And then the other thing I wanted to touch on was that, oh, and also I forgot to say, they've taken some aerial photos of the site as they cleared it, which is kind of cool. Mr. Weaver on the committee was all excited because he could see his house from one of the aerial photos, so he was asking for a picture. So I don't know if you have those aerial photos. I didn't get them, but...
So they were going to post some of them to the website?
Right, they don't
the
want to do all of them.
The ESBC website, but it was the reaction of the committee was really funny because, you know, some of this can be pretty dry, these meetings. And when they brought those photos up of the piles of logs, we
and
were just like...
Especially the machine that clamps the tree and cuts off the
yeah.
tree and tips the tree.
It
cuts
was
the tree
so
and the
exciting.
Tree. It was cool.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Very cool.
So the other thing I just wanted to mention is that I think in our next meeting, part of our agenda is setting up a timeline to start the process of the naming. So that will be officially kicking off the naming process probably in January, but we will speak to it in our next, the November 2nd, 3rd? Our first meeting in November.
November 3rd.
Yes.
I could just look in the back of here. November 3rd meeting, we'll start talking about the school naming process. And unless I'm missing anything, that's all
the proprietary I can speak to if
oh,
you like.
Oh, please do, yes.
So at the meeting, the ESBC had requested that you vote on the proprietary items. There are three mm-hmm. That they would like to maintain control over. And Al's watching me, so he can jump in if he needs to. We were able to amend the agenda for next Tuesday night's Board of Selectmen meeting with the help of Pam Waxlax and Jean Birchman because we wanted to get the language right mm-hmm. so that we're able to have you actually add on to your agenda at the Board of Selectmen's meeting in order to do this business. So that's all been taken care of. I'm working with Al and Jeff to get the motions right for those three proprietary items. And I also reached out after hearing back from Al to make a couple of corrections on the actual details of what they had listed. One of them was on the right type of lock, so I was really glad you caught that, Mr. Rogers, because we wouldn't want the wrong locks on the doors. So that is all in place for you to take care of next Tuesday night, And
that will be after we have our agenda item with the Board of Selectmen. Mm-hmm. We'll
then you can
move into a different mm-hmm. room.
Okay. So that's great. They were very appreciative that we were able to turn that around so quickly for them. And the timeline, again, I brought to their attention because Lori, our chair, had felt that taking this on right now in the middle of budget would probably not be getting the type of attention that we wanted it to. So I just wanted to make sure with the ESBC that they were not under a real constraint to get the name, and they were fine with it waiting until January. So the timeline will come to you. I'm speaking like this because I'm not going to be here on the 3rd for your consideration, all broken down and aligned with the policy.
All right, so I think that's it for liaison reports. Very quick vice chair reports. Lori received one email. Should I just read the email? Mm-hmm. Do I read who it's from? Or just a community member?
I think she usually says who
okay.
it's from.
So it's from Patrick Bowen. Hope I'm saying that right. And his question was, Ms. Nickerson, has the school committee taken a position on ballot question 2? If not, does it intend to? Thank you for your time and service, Patrick. So I don't know if we have a response to that.
We don't currently have that on an agenda.
So I haven't brought it to your attention, if you want me to respond to that.
Please do.
I haven't brought it to your attention because we're minimally affected by this issue. And because, you know, there have been so many other things that we've been dealing with, I just didn't think it was a priority. In some communities, it has a great impact on their budget. And there's great concerns over the potential to opening, taking the limit off of the number of charters. I think there's been some great intent in terms of offering opportunities for students. And there's also a lot of misunderstanding about what this is, the topic is all about. But for us voting in this community, I felt that it would bring confusion since it's not an issue that really impacts our community.
Okay, so that's it, and on to the superintendent's report.
Well, I have a celebration, and then I have a concern tonight. So first, last night was the celebration, and it was the celebration of the new mission statement at the middle school. It was held in the courtyard along with brand new lampposts, solar-operated lampposts. Jean and Nancy were there. I want to credit Mary Ellen Grady for her work and her passion that she has done not only on the courtyard project, which as we walked out, I said to Carol Cavanaugh, when I first heard about it, I thought that's 10 years down the road. And here we are celebrating their new mission statement, which she also spearheaded. And I'd like to read it here tonight. Growing an active community of strong minds and kind hearts. And I just love it. I think it's such a meaningful statement for what we want for our middle school students, those three areas. And I wrote to her today and said, you embody your mission statement. Mm-hmm. So did you want to add to that? It was just a really, nice night.
I agree
nice
entirely. Nice. Yep. She's done a fantastic job with all the energy she's brought in, all the people she's energized to go along with.
Right.
Yeah, it's just remarkable. The transformation of that area, and you know, there were a couple of little kids just running around having the best time, ignoring the table full of donuts, just trying to run around and explore the area and the whole convertible bench / picnic table. Just the amount of thought and detail that Mrs. Grady and the whole committee has put into that has been incredible, and I know it's been a lot of extra work for Mr. Rogers.
That's
that
right.
wasn't necessarily on our capital spreadsheet or in anybody else's idea. So I know, you know, your department has had a lot of extra work and time, but just the results are so worth it, and it's a tremendous legacy that Mrs. Grady is leaving, and just a really powerful message to those kids. It's a really good moment. Last night, so
it was. The other, and I know that we've talked about this, I just wanted to talk about it publicly, and it was the accident that took place this week on Hayden Row. I simply cannot get it off my mind. The very next day, there was a fatality in a neighboring community in a crosswalk, and we know that as terrible as it was, could have had a very different ending. But I was very pleased today to hear two things. One is that there's a petition that's been started, and I won't say by whom because that's for him to bring forward, which I think is wonderful. But the other is that the planning board is planning to bring this back up to the Board of Selectmen at their next meeting. Ken Wise-Mantle is really taking up that charge. I was really pleased to hear it because I know that this conversation has been taking place about traffic calming. I know that Mr. Dumas and I have worked on, as best we could, safety in that area. We were very disappointed when the traffic calming didn't pass. But then I continued to have concerns when we were talking about the stoplight in front of the new building project and the issue that is really not part of the building, the ESBC's project. And so I just wanted to state publicly how I continue to have significant concerns about that area. We see accidents about to happen in front of our face, in front of our noses, every single day. And both in the scenario that we heard about this week with the rear ending, but also with the scenario that I thought had happened but didn't, but we see it all the time, where people go around the stopped car, mm-hmm. and there can be people in the crosswalk. So I know you share the concerns. I wanted to raise it as part of my report tonight, just to say how pleased I am that there's so much attention that's being paid to it.
So we, thank you for bringing that up. When we did go through the planning board meetings with the elementary school, we did talk about the traffic light, other traffic controls for that particular entrance.
Yeah,
but we know that, you know, we already have three other schools on this stretch of road we're talking about and a number of children who are walking. I read the article today that Mr. Wise-Mantle indicated that he wants to bring it before the planning board.
Yeah.
I guess my question is that something that we should consider doing as a committee as well?
Mm-hmm.
Drafting and sending a letter to the Board of Selectmen asking them to prioritize it, because again, what I can't get out of my head is that we are building a fourth school on this corridor.
Yeah. Right.
And so this has to be a priority item for this committee. So I think personally, I think it would be worthwhile to do that.
I think that would be wonderful.
So what are the mechanics of that? We got to draft.
I guess I'll
draft one.
Would you like me to follow up with Lori?
Yeah, and then we probably need to vote on it.
And we could vote on it at the next meeting. I think you probably have greater insight than we do into what you experience on a daily basis, and to be able to highlight that and
true.
Sort of project. You know, I know that there was conversation around the new elementary school, but as you pointed out, it's really outside of our purview, even though it's related to the schools, obviously. It isn't our privilege to take action on this, but, you know, this is a very scary reminder about why, as a community, I know they did bring something forward a couple of years ago that wasn't successful, but that can't be the end of the story.
Okay.
So, yeah, I think if you could draft something that we could look at our next meeting,
yeah.
that would be good timing support the planning board as well.
I will work with Lori on that letter. And you're right, you know, the daily concerns, I think, you know, describing some of those would be a really important thing to do. The observation is that it's not community members that are typically breaking the rules. It's people who are going through our town coming off of 495 and not realizing or paying attention or whatever it is.
It's another road to them.
It's just another road, and there's no stoplights. So
they probably don't know there are four schools on it.
Absolutely not. So okay, thank you for your response to that, and that's my report.
All right, thank you. Okay, so now we're back into new business with item second B.
BB.
Preliminary capital requests, and this is a combination, Mr. Dumas and Mr. Rogers. So it looks like there's
and
a seat
Mr.
right
Ghosh.
Here.
So,
oh, and Mr. Ghosh.
Yep.
Okay.
So
his name is not on here.
Oh.
I didn't
see him. No, it's not on there.
All right.
This was handed out. So.
Yes, it was.
It's good that there was another reason he came in.
Yes. Oh, he's had to be here anyway. You can sit over with Al, or
yep. You could take your name with you.
Yeah.
Oh, I know.
Thank you both.
You're welcome. Good evening.
I'll just hit it off and then I'll hand this over to Ralph, if that's okay. This is hot off the press. And the reason it's hot off the press is that we've been working very hard to provide much more detail to you, the school committee, on these capital requests, but also there's been a lot of thought that has gone into the out years, as well as the need for design portions on many of these so that we get the numbers right. So we know we have just handed this to you tonight, and the intention is to go through this line by line with you because you haven't had a chance to see it. So I'll turn it over to you, Mr. Dumas.
Sure. We apologize for the fact that the FY18 sort of is all over the place in that column. So anything that's in yellow is proposed to at least be kicked off this May so that we can spend the money in FY18. The first item is one that has been there for the past few years, system-wide security upgrades. The final two phases of that are upcoming. FY18 are alarms at the Hopkins and the middle school, and FY19 is for cameras. And if I may, through the chair to Ashok, is that cameras system-wide or expansion of cameras?
Yeah, that's correct. It's primarily for cameras on perimeter doors at the remaining building. So we try to put, wherever there's an access controller at a door, we try to put a camera so that we can have access to see who's coming and going into the building.
Okay. Item number two has been there for as long as I've been here, and longer, I guess. System-wide technology upgrades. For FY18, Mr. Ghosh is proposing that we do some upgrades of wireless access points at the Elmwood Middle School, and also some upgrades in the high school auditorium. Post FY18 figures are simply placeholders at this point in time. The history behind these placeholders in the system-wide technology upgrades is both on the town side and on the school side. We've been carrying an amount of money each year to keep current. Ashok, can I bounce that to you?
Yeah, that's correct. And just as an example, over the last several years, most of that money was utilized to put in the new VoIP phone systems at all the buildings, and that was kind of a joint project that we worked on with the town. Then moving forward, it's really placeholders for major infrastructure updates to buildings across the district. Whether it's a major wiring job to run new access points for the wireless internet, or whether it's updates to major servers like the data center, it's typically reserved for those big projects. So that's the goal moving forward.
Item number three, buildings and grounds equipment. That's nothing new. The only difference is that the FY18 number of $30,000 is actually less than it was on when we had this 10-year plan going a year ago. And so for FY18, it's a combination of smaller items, walk-behind mower, some sanding machines, and a golf cart. Beyond that, in FY19, it's the planned replacement of a 2012 truck. FY20, it's to replace a 2005 mower. The hope is to maintain, we've always been saying this, but very seldom has it happened, that we're maintaining a 7-year replacement cycle in those out years. And, we've been really keeping our vehicles a lot longer than 7 years. But at this point, that's the target. So there may be some years in which we meet the target and some years in which we don't.
Do you want us to stop?
So I was just going to ask, do we want to do questions as we go?
I think so.
Want to do,
yeah, probably.
Okay,
yeah.
Then can I hook back to the technology one?
Yep.
So I understand you said it's for major technology upgrades, like wiring, et cetera, but and I know this might be tricky from the definition of how we have to carry capital, but I can't help but notice that I know these are placeholders, but it seems like we have a consistent number. Mm-hmm. Is capital the right way to be doing that, or should that be operating budget? It just visually to me, if you're carrying a number,
fair enough.
It's
Well, typically for their for large projects that are over $25,000 and are usually improvements to facilities. So I think that's why some of those items have fallen under.
So that's
under
why they
capital.
Differ from like large computer purchases because
Correct.
Those aren't facility upgrades.
Correct.
So that's why we do it. Okay.
Right. And we prefer, to be honest, to have those on lease cycles that we can maintain, and that makes it more predictable versus waiting for some lump of money at some point in a capital purchase.
Okay. It just feels, I guess I get that, and probably per our town's capital policy, if it's the right thing to do, it just feels odd to keep a running number every year in capital.
Yeah, I think it would be difficult to absorb an additional $100,000 in the operating budget every year for whatever it is going to be. Because right now we're already carrying a substantial number in there to pay for our leases, and that's always rolling over.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You know, the buildings and grounds storage facility at this point.
I think he might have had a question.
I have a question on
technology
too.
I'm sorry.
Did you have a question on technology?
Yes. Sorry. Are we done with joint technology upgrades with the town? They don't have any.
Historically it was a $200,000 placeholder for joint technology for both the town and the schools. At the point that Chris left, we made the decision to not be joint until there was future projects where we needed to do work together.
Okay.
Because we weren't sure that things would get implemented while there's a transition going on at the town.
Okay.
So that kind of led initially to the split.
Okay.
But we're still meeting on a regular basis to talk about upcoming projects to see where we can cost share on big projects. So
okay.
We're just at a point right now where we don't have any other major joint projects coming up.
Okay, because I think, but it's not that they don't have technology projects, it's just that we don't have them in common, basically.
Yeah, not at the moment. So, the major ones that we did, obviously, we started with the security as part of it was a joint project that we worked with them. The VoIP system was a joint project. The data center was a joint project. And all the fiber that we did throughout the town were all joint projects. It's just a lot of that infrastructure is now up and running.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a matter of maintaining it and putting some of it, on some cycles that we can replace.
Because I think John's point is a good one. I mean, if we're expecting to have a relatively consistent request across the next, foreseeable number of years, I understand why it wouldn't go necessarily into the operating budget, but if they're having a similar problem, I just think it would be good to have a conversation with the finance director of the town and the town manager about how best to plan for both of these, because I think a lot of times people think of capital as like a thing that you can buy, like a truck or a building or whatever. And if we're going to both be having this in common in a fairly predictable number, maybe there should be some kind of proactive planning about how that could best be done.
See, I look at capital as having a longer life.
Yeah, well, right. Yeah.
A vehicle, a network, the phone system.
Yeah.
To me, those are capital. The leases, not so much,
right.
Because we're turning those over. The leases are 3 years. We're turning them around in 4 years, so we get 1 year without a payment.
Yeah, I guess I look at it more though from the financing perspective too. When you're projecting it out, right? I mean, $100,000 a year, we're probably borrowing that, so we're essentially projecting out. Well, we're potentially, $100,000 approaches the kind of number we'd borrow, and so we're sort of projecting out an annual run rate of debt.
Right, and I don't remember how they've done it, but, we're not going to continue in this period of high new growth and high free cash that we've had for the last couple of years for the first, the long term. And so that's why I just think it would be smart of them to. Technology is not going to go away and it's not going to become free. So, it would be smart for the town to have a coordinated plan, I think, between the schools and the town departments for how that's going to get funded every year.
One of the points I think that maybe Jean made at a recent meeting was it would be nice to know how you're going to fund it.
Right.
Well, what's interesting is the joint cap, a joint technology was borrowed. But the school technology for this year was free cash, so
that's the thing. It depends on how much free cash they have.
Yeah,
as to what they're going to Yeah. But I agree with what Gene was saying. I think we're all saying the same thing. It just feels like there might be a plan that could be explored here.
What would the school committee prefer, you know, just in terms of us bringing this back to you at the next meeting? Would you rather not see it projected out for the entire 10 years? Would it be?
If we're expecting it, then I would definitely want to see it projected out. I'm just saying the fact that it is projected out gives me pause and makes me think, is this the right way to manage this future expense?
Mm-hmm.
And maybe it is.
Okay.
But I just, that's kind of, I think that we're both saying is it would be worth exploring. Is this, you know, again, it is understanding it is capital, but in any other sort of function, if you have an annual carry number, you probably wouldn't have that in capital.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay.
Yeah. So, is it okay to move on to the buildings and grounds storage facility?
Just a quick question on equipment.
Yeah.
So I think we had this discussion last year. In previous years, we've broken out the equipment. Now I know this year I looked at the what it is, and it seems like it's small equipment. But I'm just thinking for like 19 and 20. I think that the truck, and is it one of the big mowers?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
So, I mean, we've in the past done those as their own warrant article, not as part of buildings and grounds equipment. So.
Oh.
Well, I agree. They've always been on the 10-year plan as buildings and grounds equipment, but within the warrant article, we've defined them.
That's fine. Okay, if that's what we're going to, then I'm good. I just wanted to make sure that that's how we were going to, again, less so for these this year because they feel like smaller pieces, but like when you're buying a truck, I think that should be a warrant article.
Yep. Yep. Okay.
I'm good.
Okay. The storage facility, at this point, we really don't know what the storage facility is going to cost us, and then again, we don't really know where the storage facility is going to go. So what we've done is, this is a carryover from last year. We've put in $25,000 for design, which would include an estimate of what it would cost, and we're projecting that we would do the construction, or we would request the money to do the work in FY19. We just don't know how much it's going to cost us.
We also feel that at that point, that would be the opening in the new school, the Irvine Todaro committee would have made decisions and allocated space, and that it would be a more reasonable time to be thinking about actually beginning construction. So we wanted to gather as much information as we could in FY18, and thus the design request.
And that's to store vehicles and tractors and things like that?
Yes.
Yes, grounds equipment.
Thank you.
Yep. Okay, the next one we need your help on. Field turf field.
We didn't know what to put.
I think at this stage of the game. So what's the submittal date that they want?
November 7th.
Yeah. So I think. So my feeling is, I think for the submittal on November 7th, I would think we submit it as is.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
And then because again, we can always pull it.
Yep.
And we don't have that information. So I think you leave it in there.
Okay.
Just the way it is, and then we'll work to flush it out between either flush it out or pull it out between now and May.
Okay.
Why don't we do that with all 15 of them? No.
You don't want us to break out design and construction? I mean, we could probably
We don't know. We could be going for design in
that
May.
Is true.
We could be going for construction.
And we could be going for a small design or a large design.
Yeah, we don't know.
Yeah. Okay.
So.
Perfect.
Well, and I think, you know, we've been asked to be flexible and push our whole process forward, and that's, you know, we're all on board with that. But so there are going to be some things where it's just not possible, and you can't do can't have a committee with integrity.
We want to do it right.
The athletic fields, mm-hmm. and then pick a number before they.
Okay.
Okay. The next one's been on there for a very long time, a major building renovation at the Elmwood School. In the past, we had a number in there, and off the top of my head, I don't know what it is. But, you know, we've been burnt. So at this point, we're asking for design money. The anticipation is that we would submit a statement of interest this year.
We feel like we need to. It having you know, looking at year four now in construction, thinking about down the road 4 years from now, it's time to start the process. We did have, and I know it's unrelated, but we did have an assessor come out. The MSBA is conducting assessments across the state. Al and Ashoka were commended from the state at how much information they'd provided and how detailed it was. Made a point of stopping by to make that comment. So we have a lot of information, but in order to put the SOI together, but we do feel that that would be step one, and then being prepared to go forward with feasibility and design. Would 300 be for both? Just feasibility?
That's a good question. You know, we know we paid, what, $600,000 for this one?
Mm-hmm.
You know? But this is a new
MSBA
school.
MSBA provides matching
you
funds.
You know, it required a lot of upfront work trying to determine sites, and so we're thinking we can get it done cheaper.
Well, it's a renovation. It's not full new construction, too. Right. So the size of the project, I would expect, is going to come in something less than.
Right.
We don't know that yet, though.
But and they're reimbursed. Right? But don't you have to apply differently? I'm trying to remember. Because we've done an SOI for this building at least twice.
Just like we.
You can apply in such a way that you don't know. Right.
Yes.
So you
right.
can say you're considered. In fact, actually,
that's what
when you do
what
the SOI,
the
they require you to consider renovation as an option.
Correct.
Yeah. So, yeah. So we would. Yeah.
But their rates are all different depending on which avenue you go or their reimbursement. Yeah.
The timing will be all different, too, because the likelihood is that it would require a special town meeting if we couldn't get it done in time for the May town meeting. Annual town meeting.
So I'm going to, just for my opinion, if people disagree, for expediency's sake, it feels like this is what's in here is a bigger conversation, mm-hmm. right, in terms of an SOI, mm-hmm. what do we want to do going forward with Elmwood, what's the timetable for the MSBA, those types of things. I personally, again, for the stage that we're at in terms of what we need to submit by the 7th,
TBD.
I'm comfortable leaving it in.
Oh.
But I think, you know, maybe in probably January, December, depending on what the MSBA is, we probably need to just get Elmwood on the agenda for us to discuss as in terms of, mm-hmm. you know, maybe have Mr. Ghosh and Mr. Rogers share the information that they mm-hmm. provided the MSBA, talk about our potential appetite for a statement of interest.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
I think it's good to have it there, just so everybody knows that... You know, at some point in time, it's going to have to happen.
Well, yeah, it's the radar screen kind of thing. Yeah.
Right. Well, I mean, and it has been there. And as I said, we've already put in two SOIs, so it shouldn't be a surprise to anybody. But the one thing that I would add is that, you know, again, apropos of our conversation when Brian and Norman were here, the more we can have an understanding of what projected tax and borrowing impacts are in the next couple of years, the better precision we can use on this document. Because, I mean, I guess I think it was at the athletic field subcommittee meeting where Brian was saying FY18, so we're working on.
Yeah.
Starting in FY17 is when the heavy tax impact from a lot of these capital projects that are already approved is going to hit. Soon after that, some others I think will be rolling off. But it's, you know, if we're talking a difference of 1 year or 2 years, that could make a critical difference in people's tax bills. And so, you know, this is a very long and laborious way of saying it would really be great to have that information in case it, you know, inspires us to move it from FY18 to FY19. I don't know. But
gotcha.
It would really be helpful as far as making a decision about where we want to put it to have better understanding of where the town stands.
That's a project that's been pushed out a year, every year, for about 5 years now.
Absolutely. Well, and I don't know the appetite. You know, obviously when it came down to having to prioritize, we prioritized the center school.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, given that that's already in progress and underway, I don't know if the MSBA does multiple projects with one town or they do them
serially.
So
especially
then that's
if you're
not
at different
issue.
Phases. Okay. What were the results of the other SOIs?
It was never taken up.
So the most recent one we did in conjunction with the center school SOI, because we didn't know if we would need to do something to Elmwood if we had picked that site. There was discussion of.
That's right.
Right, and so we basically, they told us to submit it, and they said they'll hold on to it and activate it if we ended up with a solution that touched Elmwood, which we obviously didn't.
I see.
And but the one before that was a separate one, and we just weren't invited into the process.
Okay. All right.
Yep. So.
Would it make sense not to call it specifically a major building renovation?
What would you call it?
Just say something about Elmwood.
Elmwood School Improvements? No, good point, because we don't know that it's going to be a renovation.
This makes it sound like we've already decided that we're renovating a building.
Yep, Elmwood.
Solution.
Solution,
That's what we do for center.
That's
center
what
school
we did.
Solution.
Yeah. Okay, we can make that change.
Elmwood School Solution?
Yep. And I think the intent to all of your comments, and I appreciate them, is to gather the information.
Mm-hmm.
And then if we're able to go forward, to have the money there to support it. But maybe maybe it's too aggressive. Maybe it needs to be 1 year out. FY18 gathering of information, potentially submitting. When we submit the SOI, it seems to me that they expected us to already have money behind us. In order for them, they did not.
No, it's actually, so we did that, for this most recent center version, but that was
different.
That was different, yeah.
Prove that you're serious.
Because we knew they weren't going to pay for it.
Right, we knew they weren't going to pay for it, and it was that. It was proof that the community's really ready to do this.
Yeah. Got it.
We were doing it, that's why we formed the committee early, that's why we did all those things. So I think typically there's a period of time after they invite you in that you have to get feasibility money.
Yep.
Okay.
So, which again is another reason why it's probably worth keeping it on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Very good.
So the next one is just a name change. It used to be called Loop Road Repairs. In having conversations about that, Mr. Rogers actually has reached out to an engineering firm who would do some assessment of the roads and the parking lots, basically the pavement on the Hayden Row campus. So the $35,000 represents what it would cost to assess the Loop Road and campus parking lots with construction in the out years. Those numbers, I could see us making them TBDs as opposed to round numbers, because those are not solid numbers.
Mm-hmm.
The assessment's solid, the others are not.
Is anyone else hearing Joe Markey's voice in your ear, wondering why we can't evaluate the getting them to be public ways and the highway funds and all that? I mean,
but you're talking about parking lots too, right?
Yeah.
I think this said roads.
Yeah, but
Hayden Row
like
campus
that question
paving.
Has been
I read it as roads.
Answered.
So it's parking lots?
As well as
the town meeting, right? Like we can't get them certified as a road.
They'd have to be re-engineered, correct?
I think at the most recent time that came up, the most recent town meeting, I thought that was definitively answered.
Mm. I thought it was.
It's not to say somebody won't ask again.
Yep. Yes.
But I believe it is. We have to re-engineer. The road does not meet specifications.
And there was conservation.
Right.
You can't make it wider.
Okay.
Yeah.
Just making sure when we're speaking to it, that's preempted.
Okay. The next one, excuse me again. is one that was here last year, construct the bus parking lot. I said at new school, so let's get rid of that at new school. At a site to be determined. That's actually a solid number if it's built on the Hayden Todaro, Irvine Todaro property. The site was already sort of determined roughly. So I feel more comfortable leaving that number there. Because it has something behind it. Administration office solution. That's been there longer than I have, too. And, that's, I think we should keep that there just to keep it on the radar screen.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Because at some point in time, something's going to have to give, with the center school or whatever. Or we could stay where we are.
Well, and the timing was significant because not only... you know, understanding that the town was going to be taking up and on our next school committee meeting is a request from the town around what your intent is going to be with the center school when you no longer are using it as a school building, which will then, they're going to be forming a committee, as we all know, to be looking at that, but they want us to, there's a motion that's going to be in the next meeting around the center school and the school committee's intent. So we've got that going on in terms of assessing what will be going on with the center school. We will have nearing completion of our project, potentially looking at what might happen with the Elmwood School. And so there could be several possibilities out there around the administrative office solution. And so we wanted to have all of those things kind of be looking at them together.
Mm-hmm. If it's okay, could I turn the rest of this over to the
You're
folks across
trouble.
The table?
Yeah. Okay.
These are all new to the plan.
Okay.
And so they're all related to the facilities, so
okay.
Please.
So the air conditioning at the middle school auditorium. So the funding that we got at town meeting, as we explained okay. previously, was, you know, when it went out to bid and we got engineering, was far less than we actually need. So the engineer's estimator came up with a figure of 230,000 to 250,000 to do that project. So that's using our existing air handlers, and it would be adding condensing units to our existing air handlers.
How much of the current project will we be returning or not accessing that was included in last year's warrant? How much are we not using in that amount?
I think it's 133,000.
Yeah. So I think we want to connect that information as well when we're talking about this.
I thought there was some conversation that the town.
That was the boiler.
No, for the air conditioning, that the town was going to supplement the authorization under the warrant article and finish it. No.
So because we were talking about both of these things, the boiler and the air conditioning and the school committee agreed to have us follow up with the town on accessing the insurance money, and then I think we ended up being able to find additional funds in the operating budget to make up the difference and go forward with that project. We had kind of tabled the auditorium discussion and completed the parts of it that we were able to complete.
Okay.
There was discussion as to whether or not we should use some of those funds for design. But I think there was some glitch with doing only the design phase now because of the RFP, or I can't remember why that was problematic, Al.
Well, it would have to, because of the amount of the project, it would have to go to design review to choose an engineer.
And then if we did that much of the project, but then we weren't ready to go forward, that was it. Until this was approved the following year, we could be left in the middle of a project
mm-hmm.
that doesn't go forward. And so we could certainly bring that back to the school committee because I think you're right. I don't think there was ever a final decision on what was happening with the rest of those funds, Jean.
I mean, it's a big, honestly, we were like off by 50%. So
yeah.
It would be a big amount for them to backfill. Anyway, just, I think it's going to be a high hurdle to say to town meeting, all right, we were off by 50%.
Yeah.
But this is probably a cleaner way to do it
yeah.
structurally, so.
Okay.
The next item is Hopkins HVAC assessment and upgrades. Hopkins School is going to be 18 years old. The equipment is aging. It's a pneumatic control system, and we're having trouble with the pneumatics. There's leaks in the walls. The plan is to, well, consult with an engineering company to see what the best solution would be. The hope is to change to a DDC system, which is an electronic system. in that process, there's 200 points in the building. So that's thermostats, air handlers, you know, valves that need to be opened and closed. So in that process, you know, valve bodies could have to be replaced. So that's part of that estimate. The $120,000 is giving us engineering and guidance on how to move forward. It may be a better remedy to replace pneumatic lines and keep the pneumatic system, or you know, the hope is to change to an electronic system.
So again, it's broken out by design over the 2 years to make sure that we have the right dollar amount.
So is this 1.3 million? Is that a reasonably firm?
That's a pretty good estimate.
Okay.
Part of that is rebalancing the existing equipment also, air handlers, rooftop units. high school roof?
Yeah, I'll speak to this one, Al. So there's been many, many hours of meetings between the town and the school department over the issue of the roof insurance. Ongoing communication with Ray's office, with Gail, countless meetings, and a stack of email. I'm not exaggerating like this. At the end of the day, we have a meeting. We have a statement, and it's okay. And a meeting upcoming with Norman and with myself and Norman and the two chairs, so that we have a statement prepared for town meeting in terms of this question is going to be raised about the insurance. But we know in the end that we move forward with repair because we needed to, and we had appropriated the monies to go ahead with the repair, which was the responsible thing to do, all the while trying to get the installer to take responsibility and be able to access insurance money. And it was a battle that we were not. It got to the point where it did not make financial. It didn't make any longer financial sense to continue to fight it. And we have a statement to that effect. So we'll be able to make that statement. But in the meantime, we know that we have information to say that we have to call out that at some point we're going to need a full roof replacement. So that's why you see that's kind of a placeholder for us to continue to be aware of it as years march on. And I think that's exactly, you know, one of the reasons we want the 10-year plan is that we're looking out to things that we know we're going to need in the future. It might need to be moved out further. If we don't need to replace, we won't. But it's really there, you know, to as a reminder, mm-hmm. as a placeholder. Anything else on the roof? No. Okay.
The middle school roof replacement, We put a new roof in two phases on the middle school in 2007 and 2008. Excuse me. There were two sections of the roof on either side of the courtyard that were not replaced. So those two sections are the original, are the roof from 96, mm-hmm. when they did the addition to the middle school, high school. So the $25,000 is an assessment of that, those two roof areas. Let's see. The receiving door at Elmwood, the back door at Elmwood, the frame is rotting, and it is becoming a security issue because we have to keep adjusting it so to make sure that the door closes. So, you know, people walk in, if the door doesn't close and latch, then we have a problem. So this is a complete replacement of the frame. The frame goes all the way up to the roof line. So we would have to replace the door, the transom above the door, and then the window above the transom, because it's all one frame. And there's an overhang there also that until we open that up, we're not sure how that's supported. Mm-hmm. So that's all part of this.
So Al's been able to repair it so that it's not a safety concern temporarily,
But, and that's why you see it on as a capital item for next year, because we know it's going to need the complete replacement.
And the high school HVAC assessment and upgrades where we'll be looking at 18-19-year-old equipment at the high school, and that's just, you know, going over all the air handlers and VAVs and recommissioning, rebalancing.
I'll pause and see if there's questions.
Well, about the HVAC, so I see Hopkins and high school. Do we not need to address, have we recently addressed it at the other schools? Or I guess middle school, is that part of what we're doing with this other capital article that's a redo?
With the air conditioning?
Yeah, I mean, does that include the whole system-wide? So the air conditioning at the middle school is the auditorium, the project that we're doing. But then we have an HVAC assessment and upgrades that sound like it's more comprehensive through the buildings for the high school and the Hopkins school. I'm just asking, because I don't see Elmwood or middle school on here, is that something that we don't need to do at those buildings or we've done recently? Or
the thought with Elmwood is hopefully there's a renovation process.
Right.
With the middle school, there isn't as much technical equipment there. So.
Okay, so we'll be there. Okay, thank you.
We're interested in your feedback on what you would how you would like this to be organized. the assumption was that you would want to see the things up top that are going to be for next year, and that's why, you know, as I said, it was hot off the press, so we highlighted them in yellow. We removed things that have been completed and didn't need to be on it any longer. Do you have any interest in prioritizing and having a conversation about that at the next meeting? Just looking for your feedback on, because the next meeting is not the next meeting. Yes, the next meeting is when you need to approve.
I think for me, for the next meeting, it would be really helpful, again, to have that projection of what the town capital borrowing schedule. I don't know all the right words, but you understand what I'm talking about.
Thank you.
Looks like, because I feel like, you know, this is already a really big request. It doesn't include potentially a substantial number for synthetic turf fields. And, you know, all of these things are important, but we may have to, we're also building a new school. I mean, there's just so many people that just have fatigue in this town. And so I just want to make sure that we're being as responsible as we can about balancing carefully what we're asking for each year. And so again, you know, it's what I say every year, it's just so hard to do that in a vacuum. And so to the extent that we can get some information from the town about what the next couple of years looks like, I just feel like that would be really helpful in terms of figuring out if there's something that we could push out 1 year or 2 years or not.
That's a great suggestion, and we will make sure that we have that information for the next meeting. In terms of organization?
So in terms of organization, I think what you said
works
for me.
Okay.
But I think from the prioritization perspective at the next meeting, so again, we recognize that in moving up our timeline, that what we're going to give to the town on November 7th is, I mean, when we used to do them on December, at the end of December, we would oftentimes pull things later or make adjustments. So I think the struggle I would have, I think the data point that Jean raised is an important one. But even with that, I would very much struggle to prioritize these and determine an appetite without an operating budget in front of me. So I think that's, you know, there's $965,000 of capital request here plus potentially the field. But that balances with what's the ask we have on the increase in the operating budget. You know, if that's if I'm not saying it is, but if it's a lower year, I might have more appetite for this kind of thing.
Yeah.
So, I guess what I'm saying is I'm gonna struggle to get any further than this list looks good to move forward. Pending adjustments when we do the budget process.
Fair enough. Right.
Well, and we don't know any of the capital requests from any of the other departments either, and
no.
so
You know, so again, I mean, I just agree with what John said. I'm not ready to prioritize anything.
Okay.
I'm certainly happy after there's a lot more context for them to come back to us and for us to have that conversation, but
okay.
I feel like that's tough to do.
I think there is an aspect of prioritization, though, that we just can't do. Like, we don't know how close the door at Elmwood is to falling off the hinges and not being able to be repaired anymore versus that we'd like to do a study on something that, you know, is failing more slowly. So I think the prioritization is kind of on you guys to say, where are the most dire needs? I would say that's more of a prioritization that we can't provide. And then, you know, in conjunction with what Gene and John have said also, but, you know, I think of you guys as like the product owners for these set of requirements, and what do you think is the most critical? I would like to see that kind of a prioritization. And
sure,
then we can look at that from a direness perspective.
Absolutely. I think that in conjunction with what the boring schedule is from the town would be,
right,
would be helpful.
Those are good pieces of info.
Put those
two
together.
Okay. All right.
No,
I
think
we're good.
No, and there's no action on this. And this will be back next meeting.
Thank you.
Okay, so we are going to do the capital project school department article warrant first under new business.
Sure.
Thank you, Al.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Mr. Davis?
So there's one warrant, $401,721.32. There are eight invoices that are listed there. They cover Hopkins boiler replacement for the Hopkins and High School roof, for bleacher upgrades, and for the high school scoreboard. And all of the invoices are listed, and I'm happy to answer any questions you might have.
Are there any questions as to the warrant, the capital project warrant? Okay, hearing none, I would seek a motion to approve the payment of warrant 17-020 in the amount of $401,721.32. To the vendors as outlined in the agenda materials.
Extra zeros.
Second.
You guys are messing with me.
You're doing great, Kelly.
101 million.
The new yeah, I was like, I hope that I didn't forget. Okay, so moved by Nancy and seconded by John. All those in favor?
Yes.
I'm a yes.
Twice.
Two B's.
And we have too many zeros.
And too many zeros.
Extra numbers.
Things out of order.
Extra numbers.
So 407,000.
Oh, no, we had B and B. And oh, he was saying that it was. It was a copy place. Okay, so now we are going to jump into old business because we have some visiting dignitaries here. So this is the cross-country trail loop. So
could I invite them?
Oh, yes, please. Okay.
So could I invite our good friends, Peter Lagoy and Tim Kilduff? Would you please come on up here? Come. Oh, look at you. It is true.
You're going to have to move the chair to get him.
That
to
is true.
Here.
Well, then
you can go back there afterwards and watch the rest of the meeting.
Right.
I mean, there's plenty of seats.
Thank you. We just like to see you on camera because we want to be always able to thank you for everything that you do, and all of your ongoing support to the schools. This is a report, really, because as you'll recall, they came before you. I don't know when. But earlier this year, last year, for, do you remember the date?
It was in the spring.
Spring.
Yeah,
I think so. With this concept of a cross-country trail loop, which is, you know, so exciting. And they are actually at the point of the first payment has been made, but they wanted to give you an update, and we missed the last agenda cutoff. Other than doing it in public comment, which didn't seem appropriate, we invited them to come here tonight to really provide you with an update report on the progress of the cross-country trail loop. So thank you both for being here tonight. Right. Did you want to say anything else?
Well, first of all, I did meet with the two gentlemen. I said late last week, I think it was the week before now. And we had a nice conversation about how we'd like to get the project kicked off. We do have $35,000, which is the year one payment from the BAA and the 26.2 Foundation. And these guys are ready to go, so.
Right, so I think we have one or two contracts to Ralph, so hopefully we can get started. Bit of a holdup that we had was trying to get the survey work and the work done for the middle school trail, trying to get the engineers on board. There's a lot of CONCOM, Conservation Commission issues, so we had to, they have to put together a plan to do that work that we can then take to the conservation agent. For the middle school course, which will run, I don't know if it was a while ago, so you guys probably don't recall, but most of it is on fields and then in the woods north of those fields, and then partially on the center trail. So it loops from the center trail and it comes up through the woods. That's actually not town-owned property. That's owned by Mr. Barbieri, but he's willing to let us use that as long as we put a bench up in honor of Fred White, which we're more than happy to do. Fred did a lot of work for you, not for this group, but for folks before, for school work. He was clerk of the works on some school projects. The way the process will work is I'll work with Ralph. I'll be clerk of the works on the project. We've got ideas of where the trail's going to go. I have done a little bit of clearing between the loop road and the track, so the trail will run down in that area. Some of that is actually outside of Conservation Commission jurisdiction, so I have the approval of the conservation agent to get started on there as soon as we get the contract signed, so that little piece will get done. We should be able to get in front of the Conservation Commission within a month or so, I would hope, get a quick approval on the request for determination of applicability, and then we can get the folks going who are doing the heavier equipment work. That'll be basically putting a stone dust trail down, running from the center trail up to the loop roads. We'd hope to have, frankly, I'd hope to have that in for them to run on this year because my son's a seventh grader, but he will be able to run on it next year. So that's the plan. I'm using for that work the same person who did Center Trail Phase 2, so he's familiar with stone dust trails and with the process. We like to use material from the town. John Westerling usually gives us some of that crushed asphalt. We mix that, so much lower cost than having to go out and buy the stuff. So that's the plan. As far as the engineering goes, Ryan Davenport, the other person who was here with us, and I, he's another cross-country runner. We were out looking at some of the areas that are basically just a straight shot. That's relatively boring. So we've decided, I think we're going to put some cyclocross ramps in. So the idea is to make this a cross-country course that people remember. And then people say, we want to come back to it, and boy, that's a course. I mean, Ryan has big plans for the use of this trail, both for the schools, obviously, but also as a community function. So that's basically the update. We're ready to get going.
Peter, when you say you've cleared a portion of the trail, do you mean you've cleared it?
I like, wondered that
personally.
Sure he does.
My son was part of that track program that's here, and I had 2 hours to kill Mondays and Wednesdays for the beginning of the year, so it seemed like a reasonable use of my time. And I did, again, have conservation agent approval to clear the invasive, so that's what I did.
Wow, impressive.
It helps me in terms of getting an idea of how this will work and where things will go. I found actually a really, off the edge of the track, there's a really neat steep hill that is going to be, the kids are going to hate us for that one. It's wonderful. From a cross country,
memorable. Brian saw that. I'll be doing it in the opposite direction.
Yeah. So,
that's wonderful.
I wouldn't have seen that without doing the clearing myself. So that's why, to me, it's important to get out there and just sort of walk around and spend some time looking at things.
So true.
So one of the things that we talked about in our meeting was phasing this in, because we only have $35,000 a year to work with, and it's for 10 years, but we're not going to spend all of that money on this course. I think it's a relatively small amount, but it will be more than a one-year project. So can you talk a little bit about the second phase and second to final?
Right, so the first phase of the middle school, and that's the easy part. The harder phase is going across the loop road, basically where the parking lot is by that lower baseball field. And want to have the kids go just just one crossing point out and back so that you're not having traffic control issues at multiple points. That's a long shot. There's good long distance. There's good visibility there. The reason we want to get into that area is because of the pine forest in there. It's a really neat resource that I don't know if any of you have walked back there, but a lot of people haven't. And I think it would be great to have a course going through that so people can experience that. You can, you know, basically be, what is it, 300 yards from here and in the total quiet of a pine forest. It's really a pretty neat resource for the town and for the school. Mm-hmm. And certainly as part of a cross-country course, that would be a neat feature. So that will be a more complicated process. That will require notice of intent. There's wetlands in that pine forest area. There is an old cart path that we're going to be able to use some of to get over one of the wetlands crossings. But that's going to be more complicated. In terms of process, and we've just kind of kicked the idea around a little bit. We may think about, and we'd work with you obviously, Ralph, on this, is maybe bond, you know, getting an estimate from the engineers of total costs, and then bonding whatever additional beyond the money that we already have. Yeah.
That would be something similar to the bleacher project.
Correct.
That we had where the town agreed to bond it, and the way that it was going to be paid back was through the guarantee of the payments. Mm-hmm. That's how a bleacher project was taken care of.
Mm-hmm. So if we were going to do that, though, would that need to go to town meeting?
Yes, it would.
As a warrant article?
Yeah.
Yes. So if we're thinking about doing that?
I don't know that that's happening this year.
Okay.
Because we know that we had this short deadline.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Well, but we have a lot of things on that aren't happening this year. I think as far as the radar screen conversation,
you want that on there?
If we think it's a possibility,
yeah,
it's easier to take it off than to surprise somebody.
So we'll add,
and that's a relatively easy one.
Cross country.
You're not asking the story.
Executed this model with the bleacher project, but what would be the total cost over the life of this project to finish? Is it just the two phases?
It's just the two phases, yeah. So I think we estimated like something around $100,000 for this. So that would basically be bonding, you know, 3 months or 3 years worth.
Okay.
Yeah. We ride herd on that though, Gene.
What's that?
There are a couple of us that ride herd on that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to see it a lot less than that.
Right.
$100,000, including the $35,000 that we're going to spend in
correct.
Year one. So it's $65,000.
Bond $65,000, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
The alternative is to delay it for 2 years, or delay it a year. Yeah, 2 years.
To just do it in.
And then just do it.
Really phase it.
Rates, like what would, I mean, it doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So.
Just bond it and.
I have two other questions, too.
To have that conversation
one
in
is,
town.
I know you've given this to us before, and I just can't lay my hands on it easily, but. As you know, we're in the process of reviewing all the athletic fields as part of this subcommittee. Could you give us a map of where this is going to go? You mentioned that it would go across some fields, and obviously we want to make sure that everything is complementing everything else when we go through this project. We did look at a map of the existing fields, but we didn't have that one to look at our last meeting. And then my other thought is... because ultimately the school department owns this, right?
Correct.
And it's happening on the school land. Have we taken any action, or do we need to take any action? So to officially designate you as the clerk of the work for this project, or do we need to be supporting you at the conservation committee meetings, or what is it that you need from us aside from potentially bonding the money that you're going to pay us back? How else do you need us to support this?
Yeah, probably official designation would be good. Let's see. For the when I did the Center Trail, the phase one, that was the Downtown Revitalization Committee, which I was chair of, and therefore I appointed myself clerk of the works, as you know, and we voted on it. And for the other piece, I think that was simply I did it basically on my own with the CPC as the sort of overarching agent. Mm-hmm. There, so I was clerk of the works directly for them. Project for this would probably make sense to have me be clerk of the works for the the school committee reporting through Ralph.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of, and I think that's valuable too, in terms of getting bills paid. You know, the way I would see that working is I sign off on that as clerk of the works, the work was done, and then go to Ralph, and he's responsible for the actual payout. And yeah. You have to go to the FinCom.
No, it comes through.
No, it comes right here.
Okay. Yeah. You are, yeah. You are the finance guy.
Yep. Yes. They pay the bill.
Yep.
They sign them. So.
One other issue that I think you raised is sort of long-term maintenance of property too. We're looking at, we're considering that. I mean, most of the fields are grass. Cross country can run on that without a problem. We're not looking at this point. The only area where we might be doing some modification is along the loop road, along the sidewalks that's there.
I don't know.
Right now, it's kind of rough in there, and we probably don't want that for the kids. We may well put stone dust down in those areas. We haven't finalized that.
Mm-hmm.
Ryan, I guess, was down at a course last week in Cumberland, Rhode Island, and he said was stone dust all through the woods, and he said it was really great.
Mm-hmm.
He's become a huge fan. The nice thing with stone dust is the maintenance is very low.
Okay.
So as long as you run it, as long as you use it, the grass doesn't go through it.
Okay.
So leave it alone.
So, Jean, we can bring this back to a future agenda in order to officially appoint Peter.
Yeah, I think that would be great.
We just want to make sure we have all our ducks in a row.
Yeah, because, okay. Yep. I mean, it's such a great gift. We should be helping you get this done.
Yep.
For sure.
Okay.
Okay.
It's interesting that your mind went to the Fields Committee because it's part of what we were so excited about when Peter and Tim first brought this concept, the idea of just imagining all of the people mm-hmm. who could potentially be on our campus with all of this activity going on at once is just really exciting. And I have seen the map, and it really intertwines within our current configuration, but wouldn't interfere with anything. So we'll make sure we get that to you for your next Fields Committee
to share. Well, and I just think, as part of the comprehensive maintenance discussion that we'll have as part of that committee, it sounds like this is very mm-hmm. low maintenance. But and I guess the final piece, and this is probably part and parcel of you being designated the clerk of the works, but do we need to enter into any kind of a formal agreement with the Barbieri property if we're going to be running on that? I know they're going to be developing it. Is that we have to have an easement with them? I don't know if there's anything official or legal that we need to do to preserve that piece because they are either right now or soon to be developing it.
They're developing one end of it. This piece, which is the western end of that, I think he's actually talked about donating it. So, I can actually talk to Elaine and see kind of where they are in that process.
Okay, but you'll just keep us informed on that part. Okay, great. Thank you.
Yep.
All right.
Thanks for coming out.
Thank you very much.
See you both.
Okay, so we'll go back to our final item under new business, which is school committee policy KHB, advertising in schools, for a first reading. Dr. McLeod?
Old business?
The last new business. Me too.
So in reviewing, just to bring everybody up to speed and as a reminder, in reviewing our policy, and I know that Nancy did a very thorough review of all of the policies, and we came up with a recommended schedule of what we wanted to review this year, one of the things that came to mind was this one. The advertising, just can you help us with the only advertising that we've done? Yeah, because we weren't able to get, I do need you for this, sorry.
Sure.
Sorry. So we, in looking at this policy, we're somewhat surprised to learn that we actually hadn't been charging for advertising on an ongoing basis. And I believe that Ralph said to me that the only advertising that we had collected was a one-time collection from
Phipps
Insurance on the scoreboard, which is no longer there. So in addition to looking at, you know, basically facility use in general and revenue source, we thought, well, this is a good time to take this up to see, you know, I don't know if there's any advertising on the football field, for example. No. But there could be. So that's why that was the spirit in which we wanted to include this policy for your review. But also part of the policy statement is that the school committee will designate how the, that they'll review this policy and set fees. So since we haven't done that since 2007, we thought that it was time that we do that again. And before you leave, do you know what the current rate is?
There is no current
rate. No rate. Okay. And we did reach out, Jean did ask the question to see if we could get a sense of what other communities are charging, and the listserv was down.
Yeah, there's a technical problem with the Department of Ed's listserv of business managers, and they just found out about it yesterday.
Yeah.
Right after I sent out my message. So we haven't received any replies, so as soon as...
So you broke it?
Yeah, I might have. As soon as the listserv is back up again, we'll send out another request for...
Yeah.
Advertising
and we
rights.
Can certainly bring this back to the next meeting. Yeah. We don't have to actually come to a decision on that, but I did want you to have a preliminary look at it and get your feedback, your initial feedback. All right. Thank
Alrighty.
You.
Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you badly because he's not feeling well. Okay. So with that background, I just wanted to know if there were any comments or questions, suggestions.
So would rates be... They would not be in the policy. They would be the they would be referenced from the policy, the rates, or would we be embedding the rates in?
So in the last paragraph, the superintendent, in conjunction with the school committee, will set advertising rates for school and school district advertising. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough, it's not. The rate is not included here. But I think one of the things we want to be able to do is have something in place to ensure that we do not only review but collect, which is, it seems to be what happened before. So we probably want to add some language, Kelly. And
or a procedure, would that be?
Or a procedure.
I mean, I would suggest we do it the same way we do our facilities use policy, which is not to have the rates in the policy, because that's more cumbersome to update, but to have them in the procedures.
Okay.
Are we thinking that this would be an annual exercise to set these rates, or it would be?
I think it would be like any other policy review, that we would review them as needed. So, for example, with the school, the building use, it just was time to increase, to have an increase in terms of what we were charging based on surveying surrounding communities and also based on what we're paying to use, for example, Fruit Street. So it doesn't feel like it needs to be an annual thing, John, to me anyway.
I suspect that we're going to have a much clearer picture at the end of this whole athletic fields process, and so I think this is a great year to bring this back up, and I think we're going to do such a bang up job on it that we won't have to do it every year because it will be so fresh and current. But I do think that is part of a questionnaire that Dee was distributing today, I think, to the athletic directors in the Tri-Valley too, as far as what are the advertising rates that they set for advertising in their athletic complexes. And anyway, that which is not the entirety of this policy, but a portion of it. And so that will be helpful information to have as well.
I mean, I think as we increase it, potentially increase the utilization of advertising, because you said we have basically one advertisement and we haven't gotten paid for it in quite some time. You know, if this does become something within the field project or what have you, I think not necessarily that we have to review it annually, but it's a little bit like the school lunch price discussion we had this past summer, which is it feels like where it should come up is at budget time.
Yeah, we do set all our fees.
If this becomes a revenue, this becomes a revenue source. We're not used to talking about revenue sources at budget time.
That's a nice shift.
So yeah, it would be kind of fun. So I think it would be it's somehow like, and again, placeholder because we don't really know what this is going to look like, but I could see that working into that budget discussion.
Mm-hmm. I'd be interested in knowing where the money raised from this goes. Does it go into any kind of a revolving account?
Gift account.
It's a gift account.
Separate.
Oh, sorry, I missed that. Okay. Gift account.
So it seems that there's three things we need to determine around procedure. We need to determine rate. We need to determine a procedure around reviewing this at budget time, and we need to determine a procedure about how the funds will be, the designated funds will be expended. Those all seem procedural
to me.
Yes.
Too.
Yeah.
Except, so the one thing, I think there's varying levels of urgency around those.
Mm-hmm.
Because at the moment, if we weren't talking about this potential field project and opportunities there, we don't have advertising mm-hmm. in the schools or mm-hmm. aren't actively seeking it in other ways.
We have a new scoreboard, though, right?
No. No, we haven't.
No?
But there's no advertising on it.
No advertising on it.
Oh.
So in some ways, what you just described, if we didn't do a new field complex or we did it and decided not to have any advertising, I don't think we really need to worry about those last two things that much in terms of our process for reviewing rates and, yeah.
Okay. So feels a little bit, just from John's comment, that this is we could push this out to the spring.
I think
the
so.
Review of this policy, and bring it back in March or April.
Might be more productive at that
mm-hmm.
point.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I like that recommendation.
Mm-hmm. I will say, since you're making notes on it now, the one thing that I would add, and you know, we'll figure out the rates and all that going forward, but in number one, superintendent approves all advertising content display and distribution. I would also say in location. Mm-hmm. believe it or not, happened before I was on the school committee. That's how old it is. But I do remember when it was being developed in the conversation, and it was in really dire. That's when they started setting fees for everything and really bad budget years. And so the idea was that this was a potential source of revenue, like the FYN visa program, which was probably about the same age. But there was a lot of conversation around sensitivity to, you know, we don't want to turn the side of our buses into a Nike ad, or we don't want, you know, the swoosh in the middle of the basketball court or whatever. So I think right now we don't have any advertising in the faces of the students during the school day, and
mm-hmm.
that's something that is probably important to preserve.
Yep. Okay.
All right. So we will take no action on this, and it will come back sometime in the spring. Okay. So we are into old business and school committee policy EHB, electronic records retention, second reading.
In your packet, you will see the redlined any changes from the last reading, which was October the 6th. So at our last meeting, there were some recommendations that came out of it.
Do we want to ask Mr. Gosch up again?
I'm sorry. You know what? I forgot you were there. You're in the back row.
Cheers.
Would you please come and join us, Mr. Gosch? We can.
He has a name even.
Places here. Yeah, he's got one.
There we go. So electronic records retention, one of the things that you had asked us to look at was to follow up with Ashok on a recommendation around the time period. And so it's in here for not in any kind of format, but just for you to as a discussion point. And there weren't a lot. The only other significant addition that I had taken note of from our last meeting was the addition of reviewing procedures annually. You can see that has been added as a final bullet. But Ashok is here if you have questions about his thoughts on how long we should retain the records.
Good
So I'm not sure I understand the in the retention time periods. It says all sent or received emails are archived for at least 3 years, and then it says district emails 6 years. Is there a distinction between those two?
I missed the first part. Distinction between district emails and...
The sentence right above it where it says all sent or received emails are archived for at least 3 years. I mean, technically speaking, they don't disagree with each other, but it just, I didn't know if there was intended to be
That was to replace the sentence above.
Oh, that replaces the sentence
above.
Okay,
yeah. The red lined was the change. Yeah.
So all sent or received emails are archived for 6 years unless there is a litigation hold or investigation would be essentially the new sentence there.
That's correct.
Okay, I'm good.
Oh, okay.
So I thought we were just going to be less specific than that in the policy because you have the reference to the municipal records law.
And we can be. You had just asked for a recommendation.
So that, yeah, I mean, that's what we're doing.
Yeah.
I guess the question is, does it help you or hurt you to put that in the policy as opposed to what we have on the back of the page about, you know, following the municipal records law and updating those procedures annually?
I mean, I'd be comfortable if we had it in a procedures document, to be honest. I think I would probably, if asked, be more comfortable with that.
Instead of in the policy.
Instead of in the policy.
Yeah.
But obviously make it available to people.
Because in that case, you can just end that paragraph at the end of the first sentence, right?
No right to privacy for messages sent or received, period, end of paragraph, right? Or.
And then the rest of this goes into the procedures?
Yeah, I mean, I think this part about a litigation hold or investigation is important, but like if that's in the procedures that emails are archived for 6 years and web history for 30 days, whatever.
And I guess the only question I would have in that particular scenario, though, if there was a change or an update needed, would then those procedures require school committee approval?
No, that's
not
the advantage.
So that's the
procedures
advantage.
Instead of policy, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
and where did those procedures live, Ashok? They're not called out here as a procedure reference.
So
right.
They don't exist yet.
Is that something that has to be created?
They have to be created.
Oh.
Yeah.
And reference.
So then we would need
even up until this point, we didn't have really information about web history until we had the legal team kind of review that and make sure that was okay.
Okay. So we'll need to cross-reference that once you write it.
Okay.
Right. But
is it okay to add a procedure reference now for something that's to be authored in order to approve the policy?
You did that with the new opioid. You approved the opioid policy that included the requirement for a curriculum.
It hasn't been developed yet.
Which is, we're in the process of developing, and we know that that was something that had to happen. But we can also bring this back when it's complete.
It concerns me a little bit to approve and post a policy.
Referencing
a procedure that doesn't exist.
Yep. Okay. No problem.
That being said, if we are just in compliance with, I think we should hold off.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think that makes sense because, once sometimes things get posted and then people are like, where's the procedure? Oh, I guess it was never developed.
Mm-hmm. And we're operating in compliance with the municipal records law, right?
Correct.
So the exposure
and the rush.
Limited.
Then I think if it's okay with the school committee, I will also put this off until after budget because I know this is not something I would like to ask the show to take on right now.
Okay. So we have no action, and this will come back in the January time frame.
Something I have Crystal start working on.
Yeah, there you go. Delegation.
That's right.
Good.
All right. So I guess you're staying for the next one. So
yes,
the second old business, so old business B, is school committee policy IJNDB, Internet Acceptable Use, for a third reading.
So, Kelly, you're moving along.
Sorry.
I didn't have my notes there. Okay.
On
the first page, these are just duplications that you had asked to be removed. That's all those first set of red lines show. On the second page, we had called out the use of personal hotspots, and included the language from legal counsel.
Correct.
The piece that I think that we need to have some discussion on is very similar to the prior policy in that, does this belong here or does it belong under procedure? And so what Ashok had done, and then I'm going to turn it over to him, is pulled out some language from the sample policy that I forwarded to you. I can't pronounce the name of the district, so I won't try, but
Minnetonka.
There you go. That, oh, there it is, right. And so I'm going to turn this over to Ashok to give you his opinion and also explain what these bullets mean.
Yeah, I think the goal for us is when we met over the last few meetings was that there's been some significant change in obviously social media and social networking practices since this policy first came out. And I think to have some language in the actual policy that is some general guidance, but then to have maybe some procedures that really has some guidelines for staff and employees to kind of reference as a way of looking at things in a little more detail. Because I feel that just having one little line talking about what to do or not to do in the policy is a good start, but there's a lot more detail as you look at those that example set of procedures that I think we should look at as a group. Mm-hmm. Just to obviously protect our students and to give some more information to students and staff so they know how to proceed and use social media in a safe and effective way. I think, you know, this existing language example, the staff will not, you know, we had some discussion about that first bullet point, fraternize with students using social networking sites such as, but not limited to, Facebook, MySpace, and similar internet sites. There's some change needed there, and I don't know if that really captures whatever that's actually going on mm-hmm. in our buildings right now. The other recommendation I would like the committee to consider was either revising the IJNDB, and I believe it's the R2 form, which I don't know if that needs to be taken up at a separate time, but it's a contract signed by the employee, kind of a social networking contract, which references a number of things, using cell phones, instant messaging, landlines, things of that nature, primarily for coaches or staff. And at this point, I feel that if we can address that in the actual acceptable use policy, where staff and employees are signing that as part of their mandated trainings, it seems redundant to have this form in this day and age, asking them to sign again, and then asking principals, the athletic director, to keep track of all these additional forms, when in reality we already have that covered in the mandated trainings sign off. So either modifying the existing contract or possibly removing it would be something I'd like to recommend. So I'd be happy to entertain questions about the social media contract. This is just one example that we've seen. You know, you would think there's a lot more out there in the world, but there's not as many, surprisingly, out there. And so this one has come up on a number of sites where professional organizations have referenced as a good social media policy procedure that people could look at to build their own or to adopt as their own. So that's something that I'd be willing to do.
So that's to strike out what we have under social networking and put something adapted
correct.
From this end.
And so the second two bullets on the that are in red on below social networking, below the fraternize with students, those are two specific pieces taken as from that existing policy as example statements. And what I started to see was there's no way that we can just copy all those statements, right? So we need to either adopt those or create a set of our own, whether that involves, look, you know, I hate to use the word subcommittee, but I mean either having a group of people look at that or even adopt, you know, have them look at the existing procedures by that school district and have them adopt those for us to use would be a recommendation.
So it picks up, Nancy, on the next page, because I know the way it's in front of you is somewhat confusing, but on the next page where it says staff will not, so that would just be removing all of that information. I know that you helped us in remembering Lori's overview statement, right? where Lori had basically saying this bullet here replaces all of the ones above, right?
Right.
And then instead of having anything else here, we would develop the procedures. So, right, when we were trying...
Yeah, I think we'd like to keep the last three.
We would.
Three bullets, which is basically the first one states, use telephones, social media, or other electronic messaging vehicles for contact with students unrelated to school or school-related activities. That was some of the language that we worked on.
Right.
And then the next two.
And then the next two, which are kind of cut and dry statements, easy to understand, but then having a line that references a social media procedure or set of guidelines.
Mm, guidelines is
guidelines
good.
Guidelines,
the only question I have about social media procedure or set of guidelines versus policy is one of the latitude it gives us to enforce. So, I mean, presumably we hope nobody violates any of these things. But I guess the question is, do we have a stronger ability to respond to violations of them if it's a policy versus a procedure or a set of guidelines?
Mm-hmm. And I would just point out that I think that would be the main reason for keeping those last three bullets. The core. So when we see things that we don't want happening, those three bullets kind of cover legally the things that we really don't want them to do, and we would use the policy to take action if needed based on those three bullets.
And what we would want to make sure once this is updated is that we cross-reference the teacher handbook.
Mm, good point.
So you're saying the rest of this detail would be basically transferred into the teacher handbook or the acceptable use that they sign, the agreement that they sign?
Yeah, I mean, I'd like to adopt or create a set of social media, I would say guidelines. Okay. And that is a separate standalone document, but that also we can add that just like we do the sign up for the acceptable use policy, we add it to the handbook. So I'd like it to be built into the handbooks so that all of the students are seeing and reading and parents are seeing and reading it. Because really everyone that's utilizing those tools district-wide.
More highly read than our policy.
Probably.
Correct. Yeah, it's in front of the students and people daily.
And what Ashok and I would like to recommend is that the guidelines that are to be developed would replace the procedures reference under these forms that are actually very difficult to maintain. We couldn't even find R1. But R2 is really outdated.
Okay.
And so it feels more meaningful to, instead of having those forms that have to be, you know, if they're going to be used, they need to be maintained and they need to be, you know, somebody has to be collecting it. And instead, we would reference guidelines within the policy. And just like we're going to do with the previous policy, connect them in that way, if that makes sense.
I like that a lot, actually.
Yeah, I think
the only question I would have on that is that it says give out private contact information without prior approval.
Okay.
What
good
form
catch.
Would prior approval take?
No.
Unless we just get out that and just
we're just
going to
just take that off.
Okay.
Because to monitor the prior approval piece,
was
like somebody's full-time job. So they're not to. Staff will not give out private contact information.
Period.
There's no need to.
So if we read this from the very beginning and what the final version would be, the red lining comes out on page one, and then social networking and down is all gone, and then it starts up again with staff will not?
That's right. Well, social networking, the title would stay, the subtitle.
What would be?
It would just say social networking.
And then staff will not.
Yeah.
So just question on the private contact information, and if we're striking without prior approval, are there circumstances like on overnight trips where staff have to give out cell phone numbers and things as chaperones?
So that was what that form was for, that R2 form was for. An example that was used was coaches, for example,
right?
Who might need to give out a cell phone number. I guess, and this is going to be a question for Ashok, it feels to me like students are able to contact teachers through their cell phones through their email.
Correct.
And so they can email their teacher, and their teacher can pick that up on their cell phone without having to know the teacher.
Does it come instantly? I'm thinking of in the case of, like, the New York City trip or something, if they had an emergency and they got separated from their group or, I don't know, whatever.
I think with, like, the soccer team, they have a group me. So my understanding is it's like a group text message, but it doesn't have the coach's cell phone number in it. It's through email, but it comes up on their phone immediately. Yep. So I think it does address that without giving out.
You know what, though, Jean? I just took another look at this. If we read the prior bullet, use telephone, social media, or other electronic messaging vehicles for contact with students unrelated to school or school-related activities, means that actually that next bullet can be, we can strike the next bullet.
Oh, okay.
Because they can use their personal information if it's school-related, and we want them to. Yep. Right?
That's correct, yeah. I mean, yeah, Google Chat is another primary example of that. Obviously, students are using Google Chat to chat with each other at the high school level, but also can chat with a teacher, but it's through school email. And so that is a form of communication they're using. That's another reason why that R2 form is a little bit outdated, because it's got instant messaging on there. But the idea is it's primarily being used for school-related purposes or coaching.
The only category of people, I think it's good to eliminate what sounds like a lot of redundancy in the forms and additional administrative burden, but for people outside of like a coach that isn't an employee, would they be given the same, you know, acceptable use policy or had to sign it the way, you know, it wouldn't be part of the mandated training that they would go through because they're a district employee, but is there a mechanism for those people still, obviously, to get all of this information and be?
I would just have to, I can't answer that without speaking with Dee and seeing what actual, you know, if they're actually signing them, if they're actually taking the mandated trainings. I don't even know if they're doing that right
that's
now.
Just so that's the only piece about, I think it's great to take that off her plate in general, but if there are coaches who are not employees, I just want to make sure that they don't fall through the cracks.
Okay, no, it's a good
and
point.
There may be other people in that category that
time
I can't
to go
think
home
of.
Their batteries.
So that we'll find that out. Any coaches or other categories who are not employees of the district, what kind of trainings are they taking, what kind of handbooks are they signing
or just
off on?
You know, just that they're getting this consistent communication and understanding the requirements, obviously.
Okay. Is there any copyright infringement in taking somebody's guidelines and reusing them?
This is what we do with MASC all the time with policy.
Well, I figured, but they're not in Massachusetts.
No.
Do
you have to check with them or anything? I would be happy to reach out. In the past,
you
know,
they might be honored to hear that somebody found it and appreciated it.
We've done similar things even with
plagiarizing is a form of.
I usually like to ask permission first. So, you know, even when we looked at creating a one-to-one handbook for the high school program, we reached out to Natick and used some of their language. And so I'd be happy to reach out to the district and talk to them.
That'd be nice.
Make sure they're okay with it. And then we can kind of
reference
give
them.
Yeah, and reference.
Where are they located? Just out of curiosity.
Sounds like Minnesota.
I think in the Midwest, yeah.
I think we should go on a field trip.
I know, exactly.
I think
don't
we
go in the winter.
Go in the summer.
It's a pretty good town.
Yeah.
Is it?
I was there like a month ago.
Oh, wow. Then we definitely should ask for a, you know, face-to-face conference.
You should have talked to them while you were there.
I did.
I know.
When you go back, you can talk. All right. So are we going to hold off on this one, too, until we get the guidelines drafted so that we can reference it? Okay. So no action on this. Does anyone have any other questions around the guidelines before they're borrowed and...
Yeah, thanks for all your work on this, Michelle, because we want to make sure we keep up with it. And it changes so quickly. But I think...
We have those guidelines.
So just for clarity, we're not bringing this back till January either, right?
Right. Maybe even March.
Oh, right. Is there anything that means that there's more of a sense of urgency on this one?
I would assume all the existing policies in the R2 form would still stay intact. Mm-hmm. So we still have those forms being signed by coaches and other people that are using them, and they're on file. So I think we're still covered.
Cool. Great. Okay.
Okay, with that, we have concluded old business. We are now at our second public comment. No one's here, so.
If anybody jumps out of the woodwork.
So we are into items by consensus. Dr. McLeod.
I recommend the school committee move to approve the items by consensus as outlined below. That's so much easier.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Moved by Mr. Graziano, second by Ms. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes, and so carries. And I am seeking a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All right. Moved by Ms. Kavanaugh, second by Mr. Graziano. All those in favor?
Yes.
It's unanimous and so carries. So our next meetings are Thursday, November 3rd, here at 7 p.m. in the high school library, and Thursday, November 17th, here in the high school library, also at 7 p.m. Thank you very much, and good night.